Hey,
Maybe
guys,
it's me, Jason.
That's
Jason.
The one.
Jason.
That's perfect.
This is all right,
we can keep going.
Let's, Robert, let's do this.
Robert disappeared, but we can.
4K. Da-da-da.
Wake up, everybody. Today is Thursday, July 1st, and we are Never Free to Play, a podcast where we talk about all the video games we wish we were playing. I'm one of your hosts, Karch Palashti, joined by my co-hosts, Jason Wright, Sean Mybers, and what? What's that? The best beard to grace this podcast, Dr. Brubert Bruckledirk! His name's actually Robert, though, and that's what we'll be referring to him through the rest of the podcast. If you decide you like us and want to be on the podcast, subscribe to us on YouTube and podcast services, or find us on Twitter, where we are at Never Free to Play. If you have questions, comments, thoughts, ideas, feedback, please send it to us at neverfreetoplay@gmail.com. Now that that stupid stuff's out of the way, welcome, Robert, finally,
Robert,
to episode 57 of the Never Free to Play podcast.
Hello, everyone.
How are you today?
Oh, I'm so good now that I'm here at this amazing podcast now.
The best podcast.
Oh, yes.
Robert, tell me, are you subscribed to our podcast?
I was just going to ask that.
Oh, I am subscribed in every way possible.
Wow.
Podcast
Appreciate
services
that.
Around the globe.
Are you Crimson Karma?
Possibly.
What? No, he's not. I know Robert's lying voice, and that was his
okay.
line. Robert, you got a new computer recently. That's one of the reasons you decided to join with us. Is that correct?
Quite so.
Mm-hmm. How is it? How's it treating you?
Oh, it's like a lover that you haven't seen in a long time, and you forget that you don't have to settle. You don't have to anymore.
I think the important question here is, who did you have to kill to get your graphics card?
The Amazon delivery driver.
No.
Oh, wow. No. We feel
unfortunately, that's the same one that services Karch, so.
Yeah.
That's true.
Sacrifices must be made.
A question for you, Robert. Where did you build it yourself, or did you get a pre-built, or how did you do this?
It was a pre-built rig from whatever subsidiary company Newegg uses to make their computers.
Oh, nice.
Gotcha. Nice.
We'll get a picture of it and throw it up in the video feed.
Oh, it's very glowy. Cool. It's very, very cool.
RGB out the wing-wang. Wing wang? Ying yang. That's what I meant to say.
Ying
oh
yang.
Well.
Wing wang.
Sean, how you doing?
I'm good. I'm excited. Tomorrow after work, which will hopefully be a short day of work, I'm heading down to see to the hometown, see my parents and my brothers, but also that means I get to see Karch and Robert in person for the first time in what, 2 years now?
Ooh, it's been a long time.
It's been a
while.
Yeah,
it has. So I'm looking forward to that. It's probably a 6 or 7 hour drive, which will not be entirely pleasant, but Katie and I will split that up, and it'll be a nice little 5 day trip to come down and see everyone.
I can't wait. 3 day weekend for me, little Sean on the side. It's going to be good. And Robert.
I'm jealous.
You are jealous, and you should be jealous. You could rectify that, though. You're having you got a 3 day weekend too, right?
I'm actually taking a 5 day weekend.
Oh, okay, all the more your fault for not coming down then.
I know.
Spirit.
I just
Spirit
I didn't
Airlines.
Think about it. Well, you know, they do. They have a direct to Tampa flight out of Huntsville now that does like, and I was like $100 or $80.
I can't remember what I flew that one time when I went directly to Huntsville from Tampa. It was cheap though. It was nice. Anyway, Jason, how are you doing now that you aren't coming to visit?
I'm not coming to visit, but not this time, but hopefully next time, or we can meet up soon. But speaking of getting new stuff, I bought myself a new grill today. I got a Big Green Egg, and I'm super stoked.
Ooh.
Now, didn't you already have something like this?
Yeah, so I have a Komodo-style grill, but it's kind of a knockoff. It's called a Charbroil Acorn. Great for the money. I think I paid $350 for it. You said terrible name?
Yeah.
It is a terrible name, but it is shaped like an acorn. It's a Komodo style.
Fair.
But the problem with it is that it's, for whatever reason, it's just the materials that it's built out of are cheaper. Where the acorn is like this dual insulated steel, almost like a Yeti, to keep the heat in. The egg is actually ceramic. So it's probably about, I don't know, three or four inches thick, just pure ceramic.
Oh,
so
wow.
It just, it retains heat. Like, you just can't, there's nothing you can make, you know, that dual insulated steel is never going to retain heat like that. So because of the heat retention, it's easier to control the temperature. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking forward to grilling on it. But as I was thinking about grilling, I was thinking about hot dogs, and I saw a picture on Reddit that I need an explanation for. Chicago hot dogs. Robert, you live in Chicago. Explain Chicago hot dogs to me, because it's kind of a thing, and I don't understand it.
Oh.
And there was some weird thing going on with tomatoes and pickles on there.
Yeah, so Chicago dogs are, in my opinion, a legendary hot dog here, all right? They are not your normal hot dogs, okay? They got the fixins on them. And in Chicago, they call it, I'm probably even going to say this wrong, but nobody fact check me. that you when you order it, you tell them to run it through the garden, and they will give it to you with all the fixings, and it usually involves every single thing you could possibly put on a hot dog.
Mm. What about the ketchup? I know that pisses a lot of people
off. So there is not ketchup on a traditional Chicago hot dog. No.
Okay.
But it is so good.
I would like to note real quick here that as good as a Chicago dog is, it's still nothing compared to a Skyline Chili Cone.
Oh, no. We're going to get a fight. We're going to break out in a fight.
Yeah. Yeah. I've never had a Chicago dog before, but I really want to try one. I don't know if I could do it justice if I tried it, you know, making it myself. So I feel like I'm going to have to find somewhere that does a Chicago style dog. But because I've had Skyline, and Skyline is delicious, but I can't be the tiebreaker. I haven't had Chicago style.
They're not the same. I mean, you can still like one over the other, but they're not the same.
Yeah, I
would recommend.
I have to recommend over a Chicago dog my Buffalo hot dogs.
Oh, explain.
Ooh. Oh,
my Buffalo hot dogs are not known for the style in which they are prepared. They are known for the hot dogs themselves.
Oh, are these the ones you made? And then you sent me extra. Yes, those were delicious.
They're called Salins hot dogs.
Do tell me more.
They are not just kosher all beef. They're a mix of different meats, but in the most delicious way possible. And then they put cheese on top if you want them to.
Ooh, nice. I had pigs in a blanket tonight, so I had hot dogs with cheese wrapped in a croissant, which was also quite enjoyable. No, I had two of them. I have weight standards I have to meet. I'm in the military.
It's rookie's numbers. Rookie numbers.
Yeah, that's why you need to join the Air Force, so you can eat five.
Look, Air Force still has weight standards, but yeah.
You eat clouds there.
Is it because you make the submarine or the boat go too low if you weigh too much?
Yeah, it's all about ballasting. You don't want to be unstable as I walk around.
So true.
Gotcha.
So true.
Karch, nobody cares about you, but what you got going on?
No, that wasn't what I was trying to imply. Not a lot. Juliet is away, so this is a shoutcast. I don't have to worry about waking anybody up, so that's kind of fun. Which, incidentally, I think last time we recorded was a shoutcast, too. But the thing I have going on, and I'm going to point my camera up. You guys can't see it. You'll have to see it in post. Is I installed this stupid ceiling fan that wasted my entire Saturday afternoon, and I died on the inside because I've never put in a ceiling fan before. And I didn't think it would be easy, but I severely underestimated the irritating work that would go into it. I learned a lot, and I'm going to have to put up three more over the course of the next few weeks. You'll notice in the video, I don't even have the light fixture in yet, because that's how long it took me to just get the old one off and put the new one up. And like I said, I never want to do that again. Thankfully, I get to do it three more times.
I would highly recommend making Sean and Robert help you.
Maybe, if we've got time. But
bring it on. Also, on the note of a Mibra's help, I'm sure in some weird way, my dad would love to help someone install ceiling fans.
Some weird way.
my dad loves doing that stuff. I'm just saying.
It's the kind of thing I never remember in the moment. It's because the way I plan my my house projects is like, I can't stand this anymore, or Rachel can't stand it anymore. And then it just kind of gets done right then and there in a very grumpy way. Like I'll probably install the new toilet and the new sink in the same way over the next couple months. But
I gotta do a sink soon. Ugh.
But that's all I got.
Speaking of houses, housekeeping. like, sub, follow. Sometimes we stream, sometimes we record podcasts. We don't have a super set schedule, but every other week we do a podcast. And then the off weeks, Jason messes up a stream. So come check that out on YouTube. We got about 20 streams up that are about four minutes long of me being like, it's not working. It's not working. Also, we got a Final Fantasy VII video up. I think it's episode 5.
Six.
Eight. Six? Holy
six.
Cow.
Six went up this week. Sadly, I did not get around to recording a 7 this week, so I am going to miss next week's episode.
It's a holiday. It's okay.
Yeah. Everybody's going to be off. No one's going to watch.
Yeah. And then, Karsh, you put up a Chrono Trigger last week, but not one this week.
Right. I had an extra long one the week before. I didn't have one this week. I'll have another one next week.
I'm going to put up this coming up week. I'm going to put up our Deep Rock. I just got to make a thumbnail for it. I have it edited.
We'll see.
That's what I was going to ask. So that'll fill in for my lack of Final Fantasy VII.
That'll fill in, exactly.
Perfect. It'll only be, what, a month and a half late?
Sean's still making content for us, even when he's on vacation.
I'm making content.
All right. I can't wait to see Robert's content.
Yeah, now that he's officially part of this, he can't escape. There's
once again, he has. I am still in the bottom barrel on computers when it comes to doing this.
That's true. You are just working off a laptop.
I am.
All right, now we're going to go ahead and talk about what we've been playing. Let's go ahead and get started with Jason, who actually has something to talk about today.
I do, yeah. So I haven't been playing Mass Effect, and I feel badly about that, I don't know why. I just haven't been making the time. But I've been playing a couple things. So my son and I, we beat Bowser's Fury on the Switch. And at one point, Karch, you said, like, don't buy the Super Mario 3D World just for Bowser's Fury because you didn't think it, like, stood alone.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I agree with that. Like, Bowser's Fury is really good.
That's good.
I don't know if I've really talked about it in depth, and I won't, but I will say just little sales pitches. It's all the interesting elements of Super Mario 3D World, but almost in a Mario Odyssey-esque play style, where it's a little more open, it's a little more free, you have these islands.
Now, you said it was good. Is it $60 good? By itself. Not that the whole... I know Super Mario 3D World is a good game, but back when I said that, that was, strictly speaking, if for some reason you had already played it or didn't want to play that or whatever, you only wanted this new experience, would that be worth $60?
I would pay $40 for it. I would not pay $60 for it.
That's pretty close, though. That's not too bad.
Yeah.
Nice. Is it... Because you mentioned that it's like Mario Odyssey, and we had previously talked about how it almost seemed like it should have been a Mario Odyssey DLC. Is that would you still agree with that?
Yes and no. No, in the sense that the assets that they use and just kind of like the way that it, as weird as it sounds to say, the way that the story, you know, fits into Super Mario 3D World, it's kind of more of cut from that cloth. But the way that, like I said, the way that instead of Cappy, you could have, you know, Bowser Jr. is the other controller that if you wanted to play this two player. So and Bowser Jr. functions much like Cappy, and just the way that the islands are set up and the way that you can kind of move freely about the, I won't even call it an overworld, but it is kind of like an overworld, and you come upon an island and then you have to do all the things on that island. I would say in that way, yes, but in the way that they've situated it with, like I said, the asset usage and that sort of thing. No. So that was that. I also have been playing a little tiny bit. Microsoft unveiled this past week that they're out of the beta phase for having xCloud in the browser. So you can now play Xbox game streaming. I don't remember the official name for it, but Project xCloud. You can stream it to your iPhone now.
Ooh,
and finally. Yeah, it's pretty awesome. I don't have my 5 gigahertz network set up properly, so I was faced with a little bit of input lag and a little bit of pixelation here and there. But overall, I would say the experience was really awesome. Karch, I used that clip that you got me for Christmas, and I put my Xbox Elite controller, and I had it paired to my iPhone, and I booted it up, and it was awesome. I played some Dead Cells. It was really fun, and I could see... I could see me playing with more games like that in the future once I get myself set up to do it.
That's awesome. I'll have to try that out too, because maybe I'll grind a little in Final Fantasy VII just to prep for future episodes while I'm traveling between while I'm down on vacation.
Yeah, that's, I mean, definitely you have to make sure you've got a good connection. I don't even think the speed's necessarily as important as the fact that if you're on 5 gigahertz and you have a solid connection. But yeah, that's all I want to say about what I played for now.
I have
some more thoughts later on some other topics.
Do you know the PC xCloud, is there an app for that, or is it through the browser there too?
It's through the browser on all of it, I believe. I'm not sure why.
Is that also in beta?
To my knowledge, at this point, it's not in beta anymore.
Okay, because like if I could play PC xCloud, I could also maybe get a Final Fantasy VII episode recorded this weekend using
xCloud.
You can, yeah.
Try it out. I mean, it's there. It's going to be through the browser, and if you can hardwire, all the better. I'm sure you'll have a better experience that way.
Oh yeah, right? I mean, I'm sure I can hardwire my parents. So maybe. Okay. Good to know.
Your laptop
Thanks.
Should be able to run Final Fantasy VII, even the like.
That's actually true. Also a good point. I just don't know if the save. I don't know if the save files are cross save console to PC.
True. Robert, your PC is no longer useful now. It's completely invalidated by the new streaming services of the future.
Oh,
too late.
Great.
All right.
That poor Amazon delivery man died for no good reason.
No.
No, it's still worth it.
He can still mine some Bitcoin with it or something. It was a 3060, right, Robert?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Nice. Card.
Yeah.
Better than mine, that's for sure. Yeah.
Note to self, kill Robert on your trip down and take computer.
What? Oh, no. What? I have to protect Robert. So, speaking of Final Fantasy VII, because that's the name of the game, I finished my second playthrough of Final Fantasy VII Remake, the PS5 integrated version. And
nice.
We are going to podcast it up. Sean and I are going to do a spoiler cast in the near future once I finish the intermission thing with Yuffie, which I probably only have like 2 or 3 more hours in that. But the game a second time wasn't quite as fun as I wished it had been, and I'll get into some of my gripes about combat specifically in the spoiler cast, but most of it revolves around combat. I bumped it down to easy. Yeah, when I got to the Shinra headquarters, I died in a stupid like soldier encounter, and I said, nah, screw this. I bumped it down to easy, and then I just blazed through the rest of the thing. Funnily enough, still had a kind of struggle on one boss, but everything else was practically dead in one hit, so it was kind of weird. The PS5 upgrades, though, were amazing and definitely, like I started replaying this back when you started playing it, Sean, and I just wasn't feeling it, and you were playing it really fast, but turns out all I needed was some ray tracing and some 60 frames per second, because I'm a believer now. And it goes
smooth. You got a new TV, too.
I did. I don't think that's... I mean, that helps, obviously, but frames. I already had an okay TV in the living room.
FPS, though, is a big difference.
That's the biggest difference, because I started out on the graphical mode where it's 30 FPS locked, and then I was like, let's try performance mode, and then it does the 60 FPS and it keeps the ray tracing. Oh my gosh, it was amazing. The difference was night and day. And then when I switched back to the graphical mode, it was like it had broken. It was like stuttering down these stairs. I'm so slow. I couldn't do it anymore. Could not do it. And so then I started playing the intermission, which is the DLC of Yuffie. And historically, Yuffie has been a really irritating, if non-existent character. She's originally a side character in the original game. You could go the whole game, it's really unlikely that you wouldn't see her, but she didn't have to join the party, and she plays a very small role, if at all, in the main story. And I almost
always... She throws up on the high wind.
Motion sickness.
It's the only thing I remember, besides the whole getting her thing from when I beat this in like middle school.
Because honestly, aside from the fact that she steals your materia, which is another reason people kind of hated her, because she like really screwed you over if you didn't expect it to like, I'm going to go on this fun side mission. It's like, nope, you're stuck here until you finish it, because you don't get back your materia until you do. So what they're doing is they're kind of reinventing her character by... And because they're kind of reinventing what Wutai means in the grander scheme, and like they're this big nation that went to war with Shinra, and there's still like remnants of Wutai people who are angry, and they're Shinra's blaming a lot of the Avalanche stuff on Wutai, calling them like
Are Wutai. You telling me that's not a 90s hip hop group?
It is. It's what they were inspired Wutai by. Clan? Yeah, Wutai Clan.
Okay.
And Wutai Financial and all that stuff. You got to diversify. But yeah, it's really fun so far. It makes the characters really fun and interesting. She's, you know, a quote-unquote ninja, and so she's got the little headband like in Naruto, and when she runs across beams, like, you know, like steel girder beams, she puts her arms out, and it's like, oh, that's fun. She wall runs, like, constantly. Like, there's all these little segments where you can wall run, and Sean loves his wall running. So he's, well, he can't play it ever, because it's PS5 only. So, sorry, Sean.
Sadness.
He's going to play it this weekend at your house. He's going to beat it before exactly. you.
He can do exactly that. We'll bump it down to easy and we'll blaze through it. It's well-paced, which is something I can't say about the main game, but this is also really short, so it's hard to say which one it really is. But I'm enjoying it, and I'll have more to say about it in that spoiler cast, so I won't belabor that too much. Final Fantasy Continued, part of the bet. Robert, have you heard this bet?
I have not heard it in full, no.
Okay, so I randomly said one day, I'm going to play all the Final Fantasies next year or something like that. This was months ago. Of course, they both immediately said, you're never going to do that. It's impossible. So, of course, a bet was made that I would play Final Fantasy 1 through 10, just the numbered ones, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, within a calendar year. And I started in, like, the middle of April. And if I win, Sean's going to buy, like, my next six games. And if I lose, he's going to pick the next six games I play. Is that right?
Yeah, something like that.
I
would also like to note that like this is me being benevolent because I want you to do this. I just don't think you'll do this if you don't have someone motivating you to do this.
It's exactly it. Sean is the fire under my butt to get me going. Yeah. So I'm on
because last year you're like I'm going to play wins. A JRPG every month, and we saw how that turned out.
And my Kingdom Hearts thing that died pretty quick too.
Yeah,
got as far as two, and then I stopped playing. But I'm on four, and four is great. Four is the beginning of what we know as Final Fantasy, where the story and the music and the characters and a lot of the mechanics really come together. I'm playing the PSP remake that's part of like the Final Fantasy IV collection, which includes this little like sequel that they made that some people like and other people don't. I'm not going to play it. But it's a really good version, and I'm really enjoying it. A lot of really fun, like, story told through game mechanics. And so like you get a character who, you know, and this happens really early, so it's not a huge spoiler, but you're the main character. You're a dark knight struggling with your place in this world, and you kind of get tricked into committing genocide. Basically you burn down an entire village because this
I hate it when that happens.
Right, it happens, but it happens.
Yeah, it happens.
This magic item erupts, and anyway, there's a lone survivor, and she kind of hates you, and that makes sense. She's a mage, and she can cast all these spells, but as you're going through, she's learning all these spells, she doesn't learn fire, and then you're like, well, that's kind of weird, and then at some point, it's like, can you cast fire? She's like, no. It's like, but that's like the easiest spell, and it's like, well, you know, I saw my mom burn to death, so I'm not really cool with fire, and like, well, you gotta be, and it's just so she learns how to use fire. And there's like just
that's
lots,
crazy.
Of,
that's
lots of little things
stuff.
Like that.
I need you to learn fire so you can burn other people's moms to death. Come on.
No, in this case, it was just some ice, so it was fine.
Yeah.
And she, it was called.
We all know how you're going to use the spell eventually. So.
Right. So, but you know, when you think back, oh man, this was the first Super Nintendo Final Fantasy, and that we're talking like 1991 or 1994 at the latest, and like how far like ahead of its time it was, and it's like you got to wonder, it's like. Did they not have the inspiration until that moment? Were they held back by the console's like limitations on the NES? Like, were these thoughts like brewing in their head back then? Or like, was this a brave thing? Like, it's hard to say, but it's just fun, you know, going through that little history. It's a little boring at times too, but they all are when they're kind of older games, but yeah.
And you said this was a good version, but you didn't mention, I don't think, what platform you're playing it on. What are you playing this on, hardware-wise?
I mean, it's the PSP version. I hacked the Vita to be able to play
okay,
PSP
oh,
games.
I must have missed that.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
I'm happy that you're having fun and you're pushing forward, but I do still need you to slow down, because while I want you to play these games, I still want you to narrowly lose this bet. Like,
I am slowing
I want you to be
down.
Halfway through Final Fantasy X. And then a year end up. So, like, if you could slow down a little bit, that'd be great.
I already have, because let's say I beat Final Fantasy III, what, like the middle of June-ish, I think? Maybe even a little sooner. And I'm not even halfway through this. Maybe close to halfway.
If that's too generous.
But I'm slowing down. I promise I'm slowing down. And having to play through Final Fantasy VII Remake, I've got to play Mass Effect. I've got to play soon, man, soon.
Ratchet and Clank.
Exactly, Ratchet and Clank.
That's a good one.
Yeah, I can't wait to play it, but I am waiting to play it. And then, you know, it won't be long before games that I want to play on the Switch start coming out. So I promise, Sean, the slowdown is coming.
No.
I only have so much time. And then I will talk about this more on a future podcast, but I did get this little device that I'm showing on the camera right now. It's my Retroid Pocket 2, straight from China. And what it is just this, it's basically an Android operating system packaged in a fun little classic Game Boy looking thing with all the extra buttons that you experience these days. And it came preloaded with a bunch of emulators, so I didn't have to do that hard work. I did have to do another large bit of work to make it look good. But it basically has this like Switch layout OS, separating everything out by its console, and then I click in and it's all the games I downloaded. I haven't quite figured out everything, but once I do, I'm going to dive into a bunch of old games on that and just have fun with it. Took forever to get here. I ordered it like at the end of May, and it only just got here like last week.
What's crazy to me is for such a small package running Android that it's able to emulate PS1 games. That blows my mind.
My phone can emulate PS1 games.
Well, it's just that I remember that being a little bit processor intensive.
Yeah.
Not that long ago. And now we're able to do all this on mobile devices. It's crazy.
Yeah, this can go as high as Dreamcast. I think that's the hardest it struggles. It would be a Dreamcast game, but it plays 64 games. It can play DS games if you configure it the right way, because those can be tricky, you know, since dual screens and all that.
Yeah.
And it doesn't, I mean, it supports touch technically, but this is not a touch screen, so that doesn't actually work. Hmm. And it's kind of wonky when I need to use the mouse feature. It is not user-friendly. Do not buy something like this at all if you do not like to tinker. If your idea of a good time is to plug in and play, this is not what that is. It rewards hard work, which is something I'm usually not into. But when it comes to emulating, for some reason, I get really excited, and I like to break things open and make them do things they're not supposed to do. But yeah, that's all I've been playing for the most part. I've been kind of busy. I mean, some Stardew Valley on the side, just kind of going through that. But Sean, tell us some more about Final Fantasy VII.
Yeah, so finished up Final Fantasy VII Part 6 with Katie this week. Kind of a fun episode of film because I made her recount what had happened so far. Go check that out if you want to see my wife largely correctly, but also still very confused, recount the story just not even, about 5 hours into Final Fantasy VII. So we made it out of Midgar. So we've actually passed where the remake covers the game. We're back in territory, and strangely, kind of entering territory that I more accurately maybe remember at least some of it than some of the Midgar stuff, which is strange to me that's the part of the game that I've largely forgotten.
Well, if you don't replay it a lot, that's how it goes. You know, you'll remember what happened later on than what happened in the beginning.
Yeah, that's true. So, always enjoying that. My wife, speaking of replay, has booted back up Breath of the Wild. While I'm not playing it, what I've done is I've set up a little laptop gaming station for the other game I've been playing, which I'll get to in a moment. So we've been enjoying our on the couch, both playing separate games, but getting to be around each other and chat, and just reminding me how great of a game Breath of the Wild is. Just watching her play and enjoying her play, like it is such a phenomenal game. And so that's been fun. And then what I've been playing has been, I had beat Mass Effect 1. I'd started Mass Effect 2, and kind of similar to what Karch had talked about, there's a pretty big jarring difference between Mass Effect 1 and Mass Effect 2. And so I decided for a couple reasons to take a break from Mass Effect for a little while, just to like kind of forget one before I really jump back fully into two. And I actually loaded up Minecraft because I was able to get Minecraft will run on my laptop. And shout out to Feed the Beast, which is a Minecraft mod pack community. So I'm running their Endeavor, which is their most recent mod pack, which is like 237 mods.
Wow.
And I'm playing a Minecraft. Yeah. Yeah. Obviously, modded games is my jam between that and Skyrim. And I've been having a fun time kind of building a little homestead and playing Minecraft.
What kind of things do those mods afford you? I mean, that's a lot of mods. I imagine some of it's just quality of life, but some of it has to be
Yeah, and some of them seem to be like helping other mods interface with one another. The two big ones that I'm making use of. Well, let's say the three big ones I'm making use of. So, the biggest one is one called Immersive Engineering, and so this is pretty cool because it adds where if you like stack, let's say like a 3x3 set of specific blocks, you can activate them and it creates like a machine. So like it might make a metal press. Or an auto assembler, or like a thing that will, like an arc furnace that can melt down pieces of equipment, and so it really kind of ups the engineering of the game, and it adds conveyor belt. So I've gone through and I've created like an entire little factory that can automate my other process, and the mod that plays into that is a mod called Botany, which has botany pots, which essentially are these little like pots that you can build. And you can build hopper versions, and so in Minecraft, hoppers will automatically deposit their contents into a chest. So I can make seeds for things like iron ore and diamonds and whatnot. And so I've been able to make these seeds to build a resource base that can then feed into my factory.
That is insane.
Now
it's yeah.
Can I interest you? There's this really cool game I played once. It's called Astroneer. Have you heard of it? Because it feels like you've just modded just Minecraft a little bit into terrestrial Mastroneer. There's just no space involved.
Yeah, to an extent, I have definitely done that.
Minus the Disneyland stuff.
We talked about before. And I love Astroneer. Astroneer actually came out with a big update because one of the things is all the equipment that I am building with the immersive engineering requires power. So I've had to build like. A water wheel and some windmills and some other power sources to power all this equipment.
So is this not possible without the mods? Like, there's no way to build this equipment in the base vanilla game?
Correct. Base vanilla game doesn't have equipment that has to have, like, for all intents and purposes, electricity provided to it. And I've done that. I mean, and it's ridiculous. Like, I have a machine called a squeezer that will produce, like, I can squeeze oil out of seeds and mix that with ethanol from a fermenter that creates, you know, ethanol from plant material, and then combine them in a refinery to make biodiesel, which I can then put in my chemical thrower to create a flamethrower. Like it's pretty ridiculous. It's pretty awesome. I'm having a lot of fun. I've had some clever ideas for some video series that will hopefully be coming out in the next couple of weeks related to it. And I've had a great blast. I am kind of hitting my end of outside of that video series with it. One of the mods I do have actually adds roguelike dungeons to the game. So I actually found one of the towers that is one of these, and so I've gone into it a couple times. My problem hasn't been dying, except for the one time a creeper creeped up on me and blew up and killed me. It's been I've run out of inventory space, so I am building for an expedition to try to clear that little roguelike dungeon, and then I am gonna beat the game. I'm playing on hard difficulty. I'm gonna beat the game, kill the Ender Dragon, and kind of have this culmination to my Minecraft escapades for the time being. So it has been pretty fun to play.
Excellent. All right, Robert, your turn. What have you been playing, my friend?
So the game that I have been putting the most time into are games lately that are giant time sinks, because that's just like the stage Minecraft of life I'm at, okay? That's just where I'm at. But, while Sean was talking about his Minecraft stuff, though, it just reminded me the Subnautica games that I've really been into remind me of a much more narrow but more sophisticated system than the Minecraft. Like, they've built it up into more things, but taken away your options for it. But that's basically what I've been up to, is many, many hours of base building, and also being slightly frightened by the topic of being in a vast ocean full of things that yell at you at all times. Yeah.
Now, Robert, have you ever played 7 Days to Die?
I have not.
You should, and if you're going to check it out, let me know, because it'd be fun. 7 Days to Die is you like spawn, and it's post-zombie apocalypse, but there's the whole like build a base, and you have to like eat and drink, so you got to build a farm, but then you can like, you start off and you're fighting things with like clubs, but you can like raid towns and build up equipment, and eventually you can find firearms and build like motorcycles and vehicles and whatnot. But the reason it's called 7 Days to Die is every 7 days, no matter where you are on the map, a giant horde of zombies, and you can modify the parameters of the zombies, comes and attacks you. So there's this aspect of you're trying to build up and increase your technological advancement, but you're also and the horde gets stronger every 7 days. You're also trying to prep and build your defenses to survive this horde.
Oh,
let's play that. Never free to play plays. So, I think it's on Game Pass. 7 Days to Die.
Yeah.
7 Days to Die. Robert, what are you playing Subnautica on?
I am playing that on my PS4 Pro.
Gotcha.
Nice. So, but as much as I love the Subnautica, I have to get to my all-time favorite, if not because of the new topic of my new computer, is also applicable here, because I was playing Baldur's Gate 3 on my old computer that was powered by Steam. Okay.
Yes.
It somehow managed to not crash playing the game, which was a miracle in and of itself, but it was like pulling teeth. And so it's now like a brand new game I have gotten with this new thing. And the quality of life that modern technology can give you is too good. It's too good.
I like to think that you actually booted up and it went, no, not good enough. And instead it just installed Baldur's Gate 2 and you were playing with Mist the whole time.
I wish
How do you
it
like
would
Baldur's
have.
Gate 3?
It is very nice. It really helps me itch my, or scratch my D&D itch when we're not running a active campaign on a week. But, you know, it's good, but I'm also, I want them to be done. I want it to be a complete game.
I had to stop playing because every time I started a new character or continued another file, I was like, this is fun. Half of it was because my computer also runs on Steam, at least for that game. and it's just not good. It's just really unpolished between the alpha side of things and the early access and then my computer's subpar specifications. But yeah, I also just like, but I know it's not finished. I can't do this anymore. I need the finished game. What did you?
I'm tired of restarting.
What did you roll first?
I did a warlock first, but I really wanted a sorcerer.
Yeah, I want a barbarian. That's the other thing. I don't have what I want yet. They haven't made it yet.
No, but I mean, I think it's a phenomenal start. But mm-hmm.
Oh, for
but,
sure.
You know, they just it's like adding insult to injury. How every single time you're in any cinematic, at the upper right corner of the screen are giant letters yelling at you, hey, this is shit. Yeah. But so then those are my time sink games. My other ones that I spend far less time on, but are more in the AAA category are Resident Evil, which I played twice in a row. I liked it so much.
That's so this funny. Is Village?
Yes.
You beat it?
Yes, twice.
Wow. Holy cow.
It's not a long game. We just can't get through it.
Yeah, I don't know if you know, Robert. So we streamed this once, and then we've attempted to stream this a couple of times now. We thought we were making progress, last week?
Last week.
Yeah, and, but I figured it out now.
Yeah, but yeah, we're going to be missing about 2 hours of gameplay that we beat.
Yeah.
But
it happens. No one's watching anyway. Robert, did you find the maps a little confusing? And I'm finding parts to be, I feel aimless. And then at least within the first 4 or 5 hours, there's no story, which is fine. It's just it feels like they're trying to make a story, but it doesn't feel like there is one. Do you feel that at all?
I have found the story, but that's because I played it twice. So the second time through, I noticed a lot more of this passive storytelling. You have to be able to find the right notes to read. You have to be able to find the right areas to go to in the correct order. And when you're doing it the way they intended, the whole thing follows like it should with the plot. But when you're just trying to beat it, it's a little different. It's harder to pick up on. So yeah, it's a little more subtle, I'd say. Yeah.
Yeah. See, Jason, we should have returned the lipstick for Dami Mama.
I wanted to.
No.
Man. I kept
saying
that.
You wanted to sell
it. Oh, that's true.
Yeah, we finished Dimitrescu's castle. Mm-hmm. That's as far as we've gotten so far.
I am enjoying it. Don't get me wrong.
Jason's a big scaredy
cat.
If you think
he is a big scaredy cat.
Yeah. Robert knows I'm a big scaredy cat too.
Yep.
But
yep.
Jason's an even bigger scaredy cat than I am when it comes to these kinds of games. Robert is a horror game professional.
Now I'm a veteran. I had my start playing Fatal Frame with the lights off in my bedroom, but I kept having to pause it and leave because it was too scary when I was younger. So that's where I came
remember
from.
That.
Yeah.
Forged in the fires.
But
what else you got?
So the other one's a fun little game I've been playing has been called Maneater, where you play a shark that you have to work your way up eating small things to become larger, like those types of games. Wow. But as you go along eating different types of fish and people, you unlock different ways you can evolve your shark. And it's a great way when I get home just to put 30 minutes into it. You know, being a monster shark eating people on a beach.
That sounds, first of all, awesome. Second of all, I think that's on Game Pass. And third of all, that sounds a lot like Donut County.
Oh, Donut.
Yeah, but with sharks.
Yes, it's like that with the shark. Yeah.
Right.
Less violent.
I think my favorite part about the game, because I think I've watched Achievement Hunter play it, is when you like get a, like, for lack of a better term, a wanted level as a shark, the United States Coast Guard shows up to try to kill you.
Nice.
That's hilarious.
Yes, they do.
So our my fine brethren from the Coast Guard hopefully have been making life difficult for you, Robert.
Maybe in some sequel or DLC,
yes,
you can ask them to model you in.
There we go. Me and on the proud cutter, Alex Haley.
So yeah, so that's been great. And then the only other game that I also have been into is my other horror game that's not that new, but it's called Visage or whatever you want to call it.
Visage.
Used to be on the computer, but now it's out on the PlayStation Store as well. Great game. Spiritual successor to the that one Resident Evil, the one game that they made with was it Hideo Kojima and Guillermo
PT.
Del Toro? That's who it was. BT, yes,
yeah.
It's in the spiritual successor of PT, and they did a pretty good job with it. It's an independent, like, Norwegian or some sort of foreign company that made it, but pretty good.
I think I saw Donkey do a video for this game when it was still in its pretty early phase, and he made it so unhorrifying as to make it hilarious, obviously, but that would only just disarm me if I were to try to play, because just looking at the pictures of it right now, I'm like, no, never, please. I'm going to hide under my hat.
Yep.
And then that'll be that.
It takes a certain level of bravery to get past games that make your heart hurt because they scare you so much.
I'm too old to make my heart hurt.
work does enough to make my heart hurt.
Yeah, exactly.
And my arm go numb, which is probably not a great sign.
Oh no, Sean's dying. He won't be able to kill Robert when he comes down here. Then I'll have to do it. Oh my gosh.
As long as you don't get the heart attack farts too, then it's okay.
Robert, have you ever played Amnesia?
That was the only other game that has made my heart hurt because of how scary it was.
That one, yes. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. I loved it. But I only liked the first one. The second one sucked, and the third one was also good, but not as good as the first, in my opinion.
I've only played the first one, and we just did it for like one night, so we, you know, got a couple hours in or whatever.
Gotcha.
I don't know why, but this just reminds me that I need to come down for an extended period so I can hang out with Robert and watch him beat Metal Gear Solid 5. So I can finish watching the Metal Gear Solid series the way that I watched all
just
of it.
Just make him do a video for the channel of a playthrough and then watch that.
Yeah,
that's
I could
not
do
the
that.
Same. That's not the
but
same.
But Sean could still sit in the background while I do it, sure.
Yeah, exactly.
Dude, he can watch you do it like he watched me play Resident Evil.
Like, I think I beat... You know, I beat Twin Snakes, so the original the solid remake itself. I think I beat two, and then I basically over the course of our high school years and part of our college years, I think I just watched. Every time I went and spent the night at Roberts, I watched him beat 3 and 4. So
yeah. I played the crap out of those games. Actually, I forgot about that till now. Huh.
Metal Gear.
Yeah, I've never played the original version of the first one. on the PS1. I hope to rectify that with my new little device once I get it working nice. For PlayStation games. But yeah, it would be nice to. I'm holding out hope that somebody makes a remake that you can play on modern consoles or PC. That'd be fine too. But no, like I think they're all. Some of them are stuck on PS3, which I don't have, or PS Now through PS3 through PS Now, and that's just that's not viable. I'm not doing that.
No, nope, not worth it.
Because. Four was PS3, right?
Yes, that's the one specifically. There are other ways to play the other ones.
I want to say 3 was late PS2. I could be wrong.
Mm-hmm. No, you're right.
Yep, you're right.
And then 5, everyone's got access to 5 these days because it's on everything. But anyway, yeah. Jason,
I'd play 5, but the lack of David Hayter is just makes me angry.
Yeah, it's kind of.
Let's move on.
Yep.
Jason, good transition. You are so mad about something that you couldn't even talk about it a moment ago, a little bit earlier.
I could. No. I was fuming, man.
We had to carve out a section for it. And we used to have this section called Gaming Gripe of the Week. So for this week, maybe this week only, it's back.
It's
Jason,
back.
What are you so grumpy about?
Well, I'll tell you. I was, as everybody who's a longtime listener knows, Tony Hawk Pro Skater was... like the cornerstone of our friendship, like is the foundation of our friendship. It was Tony Hawk Pro Skater. It's a very important game to me. I actually, my stepmom got me this game as like the wedding gift for being the ring bearer at my dad and her wedding. So between that and it like cementing our friendship, it's a thing, right? I bought it. I wanted to buy it. And I thought the Switch would be the platform to have it on, because I know that the Switch is not the most technically capable piece of hardware, but, you know, to me...
when it's an N64 game.
Exactly. And it might have been on the PlayStation as well, but I know from the N64, that's what I had it on. And so to me, like, it's very closely associated with Nintendo, associated with playing on the TV... so I bought it there instead of buying it on the PC because I wanted to play it with my son. So I have, first of all, just the standard complaints about the performance. It's so framey. It's not smooth at all. Like when you turn your camera from left to right, it honestly makes me a little bit motion sick, and I don't get motion sick playing games. Like even in VR, even in crappy VR, I don't get motion sick playing games, and I could barely watch Luke play this. It's just so framey, and sometimes it just freezes. So I kind of wish I bought it on PC, but I didn't. It's got some other performance issues. I've found that the draw distance isn't great, and so sometimes finding the collectibles can be a little bit difficult, and you find yourself searching a little bit longer than you should have to. And sometimes, like when you fall, you know, the collision triangles or polygons aren't great. Like you'll fall down, and as you're like grabbing your leg, it goes through the environment down into the ground. Just stuff you feel like you shouldn't see in 2021.
You said you should have bought it on PC. Why do you think it'd be better there? Do you think these are all just Switch problems?
I don't actually know, but what I do know is that I've seen some gameplay videos of PC and the ray tracing that they've added, and it looks phenomenal.
Okay.
And even just aesthetically, you could just see looking at the Switch and like the resolution that it's just not even close. But you know, it just came out for the Switch. Hopefully some of this gets patched.
It just came out for the Switch?
Really? It was a couple months old now.
No, it came out Friday. It came out last Friday, June 25th.
I thought it came out everywhere at the same time.
It did not.
Gotcha.
Believe me, because I would have bought it sooner if it did, but
that's
I told
true.
Luke we had
you
to wait.
Yeah.
Let's see, what else? Oh, here's another gripe. So I have 2 Switches at my house. I have a 4-year-old. He takes his Switch on the go. He needs it in the car. He needs it for his doctor's appointments. He needs it all the time. I mainly only play at the house. So I made his Switch the primary console because if you're not the primary and you're signed into the same account, you have to be connected to Wi-Fi. That's fine. I don't care. I've never had a problem with it, but I'm going to blame Activision for this. I couldn't get co-op to work, local co-op. I could not get that to work. And the reason is because when you are not the primary console, you cannot have multiple accounts signed into a game at one time. So to play co-op, you have to have two players, and you have to be able to sign in with the primary who owns the game and a separate account. Even if it's a local console account, it doesn't give you the option. There's an error message that flags you, and it says, cannot sign in to a new account at this time. So you can't play local co-op unless you're playing on the primary console.
So weird.
Which is infuriating.
That sounds enraging, yeah.
I was pissed because this was literally the only reason I bought the game was to play it with Luke. Like, I don't care to sit down and play this by myself.
And he has a light, so even if you were at home and you could play it together, like, it just wouldn't work.
Yeah, you can't dock it.
It wouldn't really work.
Yeah, you can't. Exactly.
Is Luke enjoying this?
He is. Yeah, he loves it.
That's good. I was saying because you know I know it's a remake, but it's not like it's a it's not like the remake or the remaster graphics have brought this thing super into the modern era, especially from what you're describing about frame rates and all that. So it is good to see that he's still enjoying the game despite all this.
Yeah, it's his first exposure to any skate game, and he's really into anything that like has wheels right now. So he loves his bike, he loves a scooter, he loves cars, like Porsches. Like we went to a closed Porsche dealership last weekend just so we could look at cars. But hold on, I'm not done complaining about this game. The music. It's not the original soundtrack. That's fine. And it says that they tried their best to bring in newer tracks that would appeal to the new generations as well as the old. So they brought in some newer music that's like associated with skateboard culture now as opposed to what was associated with skateboard culture then. In some cases, they did a good job. They have a Machine Gun Kelly song on there that sounds like a Blink-182 song. That totally fits in. They have a Sublime song on there that wasn't in the original, but was out at the time, but it was not in the original game. Really cool. I like hip-hop music. Like, I am a hip-hop music fan. I love the genre. It doesn't feel like it fits, and it could just very well be the nostalgia that I have tied to the franchise back when I played it. These songs didn't exist. Like, literally, like, these songs weren't written yet, and so it just feels weird to see them here. But like I said, that Machine Gun Kelly song is the same way, but I feel like it matched the tone more, I guess. And there's other song that's, like, super, super poppy radio rap, and it just doesn't feel like it fits, because skateboard culture and what this game was all about, like, counterculture and indie independent music scene and that sort of thing. And like, now it just feels like they've just put pop music on there. So not a huge fan, but you can select songs that you never want to play, and I might go through and only allow the original soundtrack. So overall, though, despite all of that, there's something about this game that I still really dig, and I am having fun with it. So
now, it's funny because this game was so well received when it came out on the other consoles and PC
because it didn't have performance issues.
Well, right, and exactly. That's my point. Is that Vicarious Visions was the one that did the port? The remake. I'm wondering, because they probably got moved over to the Diablo 2 Resurrected, they probably had to hand this Switch port off to somebody else, and it's pretty clear they weren't up to it. Some of your gripes don't have anything to do with that, but a lot of them do. And that's always a shame that hopefully their name doesn't get dragged through the mud on this kind of subpar port.
Hopefully they patch it.
Switch being weaker, there's no reason that an N64 game, even with updated graphics, shouldn't run great on the Switch.
They're not taking an N64 game and upgrading it to the Switch. They're taking an N64 game that they updated to the PS4 and Xbox,
and then
downgraded to the Switch, which is actually probably the worst way you could go about doing something.
Yeah.
Oh, well. I'm sorry you're sad. You sound sad. You don't sound angry. You sound sad.
I'm really disappointed. I wanted this to look amazing, and I probably will double dip on PC if I can get it under 20.
Oh, it won't take long. Absolutely. Yeah. You'll be able to get that.
I will, because I want to see the ray tracing.
It wasn't $60, right?
No, it was $40. Okay. So, and it's fine. It's for $40, I'm happy, honestly, really. I mean, beside the multiplayer thing, the local multiplayer thing really grew, was the first thing that made me mad about it. But
that's just ridiculous.
I have a gripe. It's a small gripe because I didn't actually make a mistake in purchasing, thankfully. I almost did, but I wanted that Mario Golf real bad. The new Mario Golf on Switch, what are they? Super Rush, I think is what they're calling it, because it looked fun. Yep. It looked really cool, but I waited. I waited until the reviews came out, and I was playing something else. I didn't need to get it at that moment, but I thought, hey, this might be something the girls like, because we loved playing Mario Golf back on the 64, we being my family and I. And I played the one on 3DS, and that was kind of fun, and I love the one on GameCube. I never owned it, but I rented it. It was Toadstool Tour, and that's probably still the best one in the series, at least in my opinion. But the reviews came out, and they were just... GameCube games are great.
Yeah.
But the reviews came out, and they just weren't stellar. And the ones that were all about like how fun it is as a party game. And it's not that I wouldn't play it as a party game. With again, as the family, that's the primary... Like, I want a fun golf game. I want to be able to go through like tournaments, even if they're all like single-player tournaments and all that stuff. And it has like a campaign mode, but you got to be the me. You can't be like one of the Mario characters.
Oh, lame.
Yeah, exactly. So it's just, I don't know. And it's just kind of, I don't know if anybody played the Mario Tennis game on the Switch, but it kind of suffered from the same stuff. It was a quality, like the actual tennis stuff was kind of fun, but everything around it was just drab and like empty. It just doesn't feel like a Mario sports game, aside from the fact that, yes, there are Mario characters in it. And that's the other thing with the golf is like, you look at these courses, and not only do they look bad for, like, a Switch game, even for a Switch game, I mean, they don't look like they belong in the Mushroom Kingdom. Like, there's just trees and deserts, and there's, like, a Bowser level. There's, like, one, and so that one's cool because it looks like kind of like how when you would play, like, Mario Kart and you'd be racing through his castle with the lava and stuff. It's like that, but on a golf course. And they promise they're going to do, like, a new Donk City in, like, some updates, so maybe in, like, 2 years I'll pick this up when they've... you know, run through all the extra free content they're going to add to it, but I'm not getting it for now. And I'm just really sad because Mario Golf is like, I love Mario Golf, you know, when it's good, and this just looked kind of bleh.
Hey, good news. Matt's a dum-dum. He'll probably buy this and you can mooch.
All right. Thanks, dum-dum.
I know exactly how you feel, though, because I bought the Switch Mario Tennis right before going on a patrol, because I was like, I want something to play on this patrol. Yeah, we're gonna be underway in the Bering Sea for a while, so it's not like I'm gonna have a lot of cool port calls that went out to break up the time, and it was like and that one too. I mean, they added a bunch of new characters and some and new courts and all that, but it just, you're right, it just felt flat, and it's like you had the abilities and all that, but I remember. Yeah, a lot of the early Mario Tennis games were just great tennis games, and I remember like turning off all this like the big smash abilities, and it was like, oh, you can't play this game like a regular tennis game and actually win tennis. Like it requires the big smash, and it just mechanically kind of fell apart.
Agreed. Yeah, I returned that game like within a week. The Switch one, Power Tennis, I think it was called. Maybe, I don't remember.
Aces.
Thank you. Yeah, I was like, this is bad. It's. We'll get to it in a sec. I think it's on one of my worst purchases.
Sadly for me, you can't return it when you've been underway for 3 months.
True.
How? First of all, I want to hear offline how you even managed to return it. But all the Mario spinoff stuff has felt really uninspired recently.
It has. It's like Super Mario Party sucks. Like, again, it's competent and it's well polished because it's still a Nintendo game. But like, bare minimum effort. Like the tennis game.
That's exactly what it feels like.
The golf game, Super Mario Party, even this the one where they're remastering the old Mario, like the 64 Mario boards, even that looks like I'm gonna wait on that one too, because it just doesn't look like they're putting their best foot forward. It looks like they're just putting their cash foot forward.
And why wasn't that DLC for Mario Party?
That too? Like, I don't know, man. It's not good. Where's my Mario sequel? Give me Frog. Where's Odyssey 2?
Dogpile, Robert, tell us how angry you are at Nintendo.
I want to beat them up with violence because that's, you know, great. What? It is unacceptable, okay? They could have come out with more DLC for Mario Kart by now. They could have.
Yeah.
Nothing's stopping them.
Freaking Mario Kart 9.
They also could have done a 35th anniversary Legend of Zelda thing too. We're not getting that either, but we've been over that.
No. Stupid Nintendo. This is still Nintendo better about cast. That.
Now put out Breath of the Wild 2 so I can buy it immediately, damn it.
Drink break.
Robert.
Dr. Brackleberry.
Shut up, Jason. Shut up.
Look, that's my theme song, okay?
Now that Jason sung you in, tell us about yourself, because apparently I was a rude host and just sidestepped you as a person, denied you. So how do you know us, Robert?
Robert is just a force of nature.
How do you know us, Robert?
Well, I know everyone from middle school. I know all you guys from sixth grade and onwards.
It's awesome.
And I discovered all of you through Sean, who I met in our sixth grade science class, I believe.
Correct.
And I followed him around.
Because I threw pencils at you.
Because he threw pencils at me and also gave me Jedi tests. And
that's amazing. Yeah. I did not know that.
It was enough for me to go, well, I might as well spend the rest of my life being best friends with these guys. So...
That's awesome.
Jason and I also met through pencil violence. I was gonna say that. Like one of those mechanical pencils that had the metal tip outside of the plastic part before the lead came out, and I was just kept jabbing him in the arm. I was like, hey, this new kid's sitting next to me. It was just hilarious because I wasn't that kid. I didn't do that to people, but for some reason I was like, I can totally just poke this guy.
And I liked it.
And he did.
And thus was a beautiful friendship born.
I gotta ask you about your gaming history, Robert. What's your first introduction into gaming, and then what did you gravitate towards as you aged?
My first real video games were on the Super Nintendo, which were Super Mario Brothers.
Legit.
And it was an old Spider-Man game. I can't even remember.
Oh my
what
god,
it was
I remember
Maximum
that game.
Carnage.
Maximum Carnage. That was it. That was the other first game I ever had.
Amazing. I remember renting that from Mel's.
That cartridge was sitting in a corner in that back den room that we used to hang out in all the time for literally for all I know, it's still there. But it just sat there at the bottom of an end table. And when I'd sit on the couch next to it, I was like, yep, there's old Maximum Carnage. Because it was a red cartridge. It was like a blood red cartridge. And so it was super noticeable. I was like, yep, there it is.
Yes.
Good old faithful.
God.
Now, Robert, was that yours? Or was that did that just happen to be at your house? Was that at an aunt or uncle's?
No, that was mine. Nice. That was my first one. And I remember it was in elementary school I got it. Yeah, that was some good times right there.
And did you continue to be a Nintendo kid?
Only, it turns out, because Nintendo, in my opinion, makes the funnest or most fun multiplayer games. They know, even though I want to beat them up with violence, as I said, I will begrudgingly give them the award for most fun. I'm not talking about the most impressive or the best story. I'm just talking about if you want to get together with your friends and play Smash Brothers, no other company has gotten on this theme like they did.
I would like to tell a story on that.
Go ahead.
So Robert was the first out of all of our groups of friends who got a car.
Yes.
Was it a Taurus?
It was a Nissan Maxima.
Nissan Maxima, which was
97 Nissan Maxima.
Whatever, the punishment that a bunch of 16 and onward year olds do to cars. But I distinctly remember, Robert, you and I taking your car and go and driving to a GameStop or something for because we had pre-ordered Super Smash Bros. Melee on the GameCube. And picking that up from the GameStop at midnight, going back to your house, and then playing that game until 8 a.m., at which point we had unlocked all but a small handful of the, I don't know, 20-something characters that game had, which seemed super impressive at the time. Whereas we then passed out for a couple hours, woke back up, ate food, and then continued to play Smash Bros. For another 8 hours.
Yeah, that sounds exactly like one of our... marathon pre-order get things back when pre-ordering was fun.
I miss those days so much.
They were fun
back when pre-orders were necessary if you actually wanted to get a game on day one.
Right. Gosh.
All right, now that my duties are fulfilled, my obligations are out of the way, stop talking about Robert. We're going to get on into the topic of the show. And it's not one topic this week since we got lazy. And then Robert decided to join, and so it kind of worked out. We're just going to do a bunch of little micro topics. And we'll try not to spend 40 minutes talking about each and every single one. So I'll start first. And the first one is the first game you ever bought with your own money. And now, I was pretty loose with this definition of own money because, I don't know, mine's going to be from when I was a kid. And obviously, I didn't really have any money as a kid. It was still always like gifts or allowance, right, or whatever. Right. That kind of counts. You earn that by being alive, right? That counts.
Yeah.
Well, but yeah, mine. What would you say?
It counts if you had the agency to say you wanted it, like without your parents going, "Do you want this?" That counts. Yeah,
exactly. And that's a good point because so mine was Pokemon Blue. I had swapped Pokemon friend's Pokemon Red at school, gave him some of my games, and then like a week later we reswapped. I wish he had forgotten. I could have just stolen it because that was my first foray into Pokemon. I knew what it was, and that's why I wanted to play it so bad. I played on his file because I didn't know what was going on. I knew enough not to erase somebody's save file. I wasn't that stupid, but I also didn't know that, hey, maybe I shouldn't just like do a bunch of stuff and then save over his file, like on the progress that I made. I got his Tentacruel up to like level 40, not knowing what I was doing. It wouldn't listen to me because that's how it works.
You have the badges.
Exactly. And he's just like, oh, I went to sleep. I was like, this game's kind of stupid, but I need more of it. So eventually I got enough of my, you know, I scraped together my kid money and went to go buy Pokemon Blue. And I think it was like $40 at the time, which was pretty steep. And my dad always begrudgingly accepted my video game hobby, as at least when I was younger. And then later he was like, oh, whatever, this is what he's doing. But I remember he tried to talk me out of it. He's like, oh, you know, you want to spend all your money on this? Because it was probably like all I had in my little piggy bank. And I was like, yes, I need this. I need this game. And it had Blastoise on it, and it was the best. And I loved it.
Yeah. Blue it version decision. For life. But
do you remember the commercial for it?
Oh, yeah. The one where they tried to, well, I remember one of them, which was the one where he put the weird bus driver.
Yes, like, that's the one.
Puts them all in the garbage
Yes,
can.
That's the
It's like, gotta catch them all, but also murder them. Because he was like insane.
That was one of
the commercials that got me. And then, you know, I think the cards that started coming out or the show started coming out, like all around the same time, at least over in the US.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't long before I knew it was a video game. And, you know, that was my first RPG. And a lot of people call it baby's first RPG because it is. And that kind of hooked me for the, like, every time I saw a game like, oh, it's kind of like Pokemon. I was like, oh, it's nothing like Pokemon. It's like a million times better. And that is a blessing and a curse. And then the only the game I bought with my actual hard-earned money from a job, this is a kind of a cheat, but it was the Wii and, of course, Twilight Princess, Zelda Twilight Princess that came with it when it launched. Mm. Technically, I didn't buy it. I was supposed to pay the guy back like the next week when I got paid. But, you know, when I buy a house, I take a loan out. I just, you know, I pay them, and if I don't, they take it back. But this guy doesn't have that rule, and I don't know where he is. So I still technically
You gotta find him. Hey, what's his name?
No, we're not doing that. We're not.
If you're out there, I will pay for it.
I think already on an earlier episode of this podcast, we said that if he ever reaches out to Karch will pay him back.
Oh, I will. Absolutely. I'm a grown man with my own bank account.
But
my
you're
own
not
going
to find him. He's going to ask you.
He's got to find us. This is what the purpose of this podcast is, to find that man.
What's his man's name?
No.
What's his first name?
He knows who he is.
Matt?
No, it's not Matt.
I think his name is Matt.
It's moving on.
Kind of close to Matt. Moving on. Jason, what was the first game you ever bought with your own money?
So I couldn't remember the first game. I may have purchased something before this game. But the first game that made an impression on me that I remember buying was not actually until 6th grade, maybe 7th grade. And it was Enter the Matrix, which was rated T for teen, and I definitely was not 13. But despite that, I remember my brother and I used to scavenge change from our house, and our parents didn't care. They were like, if you find coins in the house, they're yours. And we did this all the time for forever because I don't know why my parents had this propensity to just buy stuff. And it was the 90s, so, you know, or early 2000s. So, like, not, you know, credit cards weren't as prevalent as they are today. And there was no Apple Pay. So cash all the time, coins all the time, laying all around the house, in the cars, in the seat cushions, etc. We had a little zipper suitcase full of change, and that thing was heavy. Yeah. And we carried it from our house down to the Walmart. Just my brother and I. We walked there on foot. And when we got down there, I remember we bought that game with all that change, and we didn't even wrap it because we didn't know that was the thing. We were just like, take my change. Put it in rolls. We gave them a suitcase full of change, $60.
That's hilarious.
God.
And they put in their little Coinstar thing, and they were like, don't do this again. They literally said that to us. They said, don't do this again. The first game I ever bought.
Did you go there to buy Enter the Matrix, or did you go there with a suitcase full of change, not sure what you were going to get?
I believe I went there to buy this game because, if I'm not mistaken, you rented it. Yeah. And I played it at your house, and I thought it was amazing, and I had to get it.
I ended up getting it eventually, too. I just don't remember when.
Right. I remember binging this game with you, and Karch, and I remember, like, literally, we played it for so long that I was seeing slow motion green in real life.
I think I remember you telling me when we were that age that you were, that's how much you'd play, that you were seeing that.
It was wild, dude. And let's not forget the... the actually filmed lesbian kiss scene that Karch will never forget.
I'll never
That's
forget
how it. He became a man.
That's how I be- No. Wait, what? Why did they do that?
I don't know. We've talked about it before. I honestly had forgotten about it, but you reminded me.
Seems expensive for a video game, even at the time. Anyway, Sean, what was the first game you bought with your own money?
So we talked about before that I bought a GameCube. And I was trying to think if that was the first thing I had bought, and eventually dawned to me, I bought before that on the N64 the Majora's Mask, and the main reason I remember that I bought this was because I remember going through the rigmarole of having to make sure that we had the memory upgrade that came out for the N64.
Oh.
Before I went and bought this, because I realized I was going to need it, and so. I think like the memory upgrade came with like Donkey Kong 64 or something like that.
Yes, it did.
And so I remember like my brother got that, and then I was like, oh good, I can go buy Majora's Mask now. And so I used some of my at that age for doing some chores around the house and mowing the lawn and whatnot. I made a little bit of money, and so I was able to use money that I'd saved off to go buy Majora's Mask.
I forgot
because
to say
because
this.
I'd loved Ocarina of Time so much.
Some of the change that I took down to that Walmart came from my neighbor. I used to mow his grass front and back for $5 in quarters. That's bullcrap.
So he gave
especially
you a roll,
the quarters like, part.
They gave you half a roll because
I
roll
don't even think they
what,
were rolled,
bucks?
Dude. They were not rolled.
Jeez.
He worked for Frito-Lay, which I guess is maybe how he got the quarters. Maybe he was stealing from work because maybe he was the guy that had to go change the change out. Maybe
from
he
the
stole
maybe.
$5 a week in quarters.
What an accusation. Jason just flinging out criminal act.
Mr. Jim, you're a criminal. First of all, it's a criminal. It's criminal to hire an underage worker to mow the front and back of your lawn in Florida heat for $5.
Oh, I mean, that's probably how much my if that that my dad paid me for mowing the lawn, and we
yeah,
had
but
a
you're related
quarter
to him.
Acre. Yeah, so.
And here's the second
I like
thing.
Doing it.
That dude won Lawn of the Month in our neighborhood.
What? It wasn't that good.
Anyway, I'm done.
Good. Thank you for stepping all over Sean's thing with your quarter grief.
Oh, crap. I forgot I wasn't even supposed to be talking. Sorry.
Robert,
what did you
what
buy,
was...
Sean?
He already said
already did it. Robert, go on.
What's your worst mask?
Robert, what did you buy? What was the first game you bought with your own money?
It was a computer game on a Macintosh called Myst.
Macintosh?
Oh, wow.
In the 90s,
that's
actually.
An old one. Yeah.
It was a game that I had originally played. It was in my gifted class, actually, in school. It was like a free time game that you could play if you did other stuff. And so, but I was always jealous because everybody else could go do their stuff. So I was like, I realized I can buy my own validation by just buying this game. I just do it. So,
Yeah. This is, screw being this is gifted.
Why, this is why Robert has a PhD, because when we got to that gifted time, we all played like SimCity and that dinosaur game, and Robert was all solving mind puzzles and this.
I like that he didn't necessarily, I'm sure he enjoyed the game. In fact, I know he did, but like, I like how he mostly bought it out of spite.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Oh, that's perfect. All right. Next topic is last game you pre-ordered, and then why did you do it? Was it a good experience or bad experience? Because pre-orders can burn you. And mine was Kingdom Hearts 3 was the last game I pre-ordered with any sense of like ahead of time. So I often pre-order games like the night before, quote unquote pre-order, just so I can install them and play them either at midnight or the next day. I'm not really necessarily talking about that. This is like an anticipation of a game. And yeah, mine was Kingdom Hearts 3. And I don't regret pre-ordering it per se, but you know, I was definitely more than mildly disappointed with how that turned out because it wasn't that good. It wasn't that good. One day I'll replay.
You still beat it twice though, right?
No, I beat it. I beat it once, and then I platinumed it.
Oh, okay.
It's the only game I've ever gotten a platinum trophy for, and I think I was just like hoping. I was like, there's more here. I'll find it. I'll find the joy. I never found the joy. I found the opposite of joy because I hate platinuming games. I'm never going to do it again.
Yeah, it's...
it kills the fun. Jason, what was the last game you pre-ordered?
Last game I pre-ordered, maybe one of the only games I've ever pre-ordered, Diablo 3. And I super, 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 super regret that.
Wasn't very good
for more reasons than one, but does anybody remember like the infamous error code from Diablo 3 the night of launch?
I do, because I played it then too. I didn't,
yeah, well,
it,
you didn't just... you didn't play it, you
right,
tried
exactly. Yeah.
But for anybody who doesn't know, the night, so Diablo 3 came out what, like 10 to 12 years after Diablo 2,
something like that,
maybe more. Mm-hmm. Let's see, Diablo 2 came out in 99. Diablo 3 came out in like,
I think it's 2011.
2010, 2011. So anyway, yeah, about 10, 11 years. And everybody really was anticipating this game, and it was hyped for the community at least. I mean, I played a ton of Diablo 2, and I was so stoked for this game. And then I pre-ordered it the minute release. Not only did I pre-order it, but also Greg pre-ordered it. So we had two copies that we picked up that night. We were just so excited to play. And we went to the midnight release, and there was no like early thing. There was no preload. Like, this was a physical copy of the game that you had to get, take it home, install it, download patches, et cetera, et cetera. It was like a process. So I remember not even being able to try to get into a game until like 2 a.m. or 2:30 a.m., something like that. And then there was that infamous error code that just kicked you. I mean, you just couldn't get into you could not get into the game. Like, you couldn't play it. You just straight up couldn't play it. So I think we were so mad. We didn't, Diablo 3 didn't have a single player, right?
I mean, it was always online, still is. But you had a campaign, and you could just play.
I say there's a storyline there, yeah.
Right, right. I just can't remember if we were so mad that we decided not to play single player.
No, there was, you had to be online. That was part of, that's what made that code so nasty, and
right,
so many
right,
people
right.
hated so much about that game was that it was always online.
Yeah. So anyway, I got a gripe
about always online games at some point.
Do it right now, man. Do it right now. I'm done.
No,
Diablo 3,
right.
I will
don't
never pre-order
right
another
now.
Game again.
No, nope, I'll save it.
Say, okay, well, I'm just saying right now that I will never pre-order another game ever, 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 because there's no reason to, because you can get it digitally. You're never going to not be able to get it. Why would you ever pre-order a game?
True. At this point, there's just no reason. So, Sean, what did you happily pre-ordered last?
So you know, Jason talks about the fact that pre-ordering, you know, is totally unnecessary, certainly in the digital age. But even there was even a point. So, like, I remember pre-ordering games on the GameCube because, you know, 64 and GameCube, because if you didn't, you wouldn't be able to get the game for a couple weeks.
A lot of Nintendo games, were.
But that kind of died off in the Wii 360 PS3 era. Where,
pretty
you know,
much.
like supply even at release could meet demand. And so by that point, you know, I had stopped pre-ordering games, wanting games, but every so often, you know, you could pre-order a game, and that's where they really started coming out. They're like, oh, but if you pre-order the game, we'll give you this cool thing in the game, or it'll come with this cool physical thing. And so Fallout New Vegas came out, and I'd had a good time. My roommate in college had gotten Fallout 3, and I'd really enjoyed it. So I pre-ordered New Vegas because, and that was the one where, like, depending upon where you pre-ordered it, you got different pre-order pre-order rewards, you know, and they're all items in the game. And I think GameStop had one where, like, you would get this canteen. And Fallout New Vegas was the one that had the, like, hardcore survival mode where you had to eat and sleep and drink. And as we've all learned, that was probably the game where I learned that, oh, I like this. I like this forcing me to deal with the needs of my character. And that canteen could offset your thirst a little bit. So I pre-ordered Fallout New Vegas, and then I did that one, enjoyed the rewards, and then it was kind of, I remember next, whatever the next games were, I started looking at and be like, eh, these rewards are small and stupid and not worth it. And I haven't pre-ordered a game since.
Yeah, those digital-only rewards are eh. And then, like, to your point a moment ago about, like, supply and demand, pre-ordering used to just be like, I'm going to put $5 down, reserve my copy, please, and I'll pay the rest later. These days, it's give me the full money up front.
Yeah.
Because it's a giant scam.
Yeah, so. We talked about Super Smash Bros. Melee. You know, a lot of those Nintendo games, you went to GameStop and said, I'll give you $5 now, and you'll guarantee me that I can get a, you know, basically, it means you'll order me a copy when you put in your order from Nintendo, so I'm guaranteed a copy.
Right.
And I was always happy to do that.
Yeah, knowing even if you didn't pick it up, they'd sell through it eventually. So
yeah.
All right, Robert, what was the last couple of games that you pre-ordered?
The last game I pre-ordered literally was Resident Evil Village, actually. But
boo.
I did it because
why? Stop supporting them.
It was literally 0% more expensive to do that, and yet I was able to play it exactly at midnight by doing that.
Robert usually buys physical. Okay. Robert doesn't normally do digital. This is somewhat out of the ordinary for him.
Actually, lately, I've been moving more to digital.
Well, there
Me
you
too.
Go.
For you.
We're all digital on this side of the fence.
Yeah.
Only because I just bought a Series S for some reason.
You don't have a disc drive, right?
Yeah, not anymore. I'm forced to be digital despite whatever I might feel.
Yeah.
There's still some reasons. There's still a benefit to it.
Like the stuff they give you is no longer good, but...
No.
No, it's not. It's if you ask me, like, I have no qualms about not pre-ordering either. Like, it's just whatever gets me it faster, you know?
Do you remember the last game you pre-ordered, like, ahead of time? Like, so I said
yes.
Kingdom Hearts 3. Yeah. It was, like, 2 weeks ahead of time.
Yeah, mine was the last Batman game that came out. Whatever. Batman.
Arkham Knight?
It could
Knight,
be.
Yes.
Arkham something.
I remember we played
Knight,
that
was the last one.
The morning of your wedding. I didn't know how to drive the Batmobile. It was terrible.
Yes, awesome. I remember that. Yes.
That Batmobile was really hard to drive.
That's what everyone said, and apparently they were right. I also had never used a PS4 controller at that point, and so I had no idea what I was doing. All right, next question is, first game you ever beat? And mine was, I can still vaguely remember my mom's apartment in the corner where the TV was and sunlight coming through the window, blah, blah, blah. But it was Kirby's Adventure on the NES. And man, what a ride that was. I couldn't have been older than six. What did you say?
That's a fun game.
It's a really fun game. It's way better than it. Like, so Kirby got its start on the Game Boy with Kirby's Dream Land. And then at the very, very tail end of the NES's life, I think probably after this, and almost certainly after the Super Nintendo had launched, this came out for it. And it was all that game, but way better and a beautiful color. It's just a really good looking NES game.
This is the one, it had the little quick draw minigame, the dueling minigame.
Yeah, it had a little Wild West, and it had the little.
Are you smacking them with fans?
Thing. Yep. And then there was another one, I can't remember, but some great boss battles. It was the first game that ever had, that I'd ever beaten roll credits on. But it also had a face. So you fight Dedede at the end.
Yep.
And then when you beat him, something comes out of like a fountain or the star rod that he had, and it's Nightmare. His name is Nightmare. And then he has like three different forms. And I died to him a few times, and I was like so discouraged. Little baby cartridge, just like, but I had to keep going. And I finally beat it. And I just remember this like kind of like, nobody cares. Like, no, it's like I think I might have told my mom, and she's like, "Whatever." And like, nobody cared. This huge
that can't be true. That
me.
Can't be true.
That nobody cared.
It's a well-known fact that you love your mom because she watched you beat your video games.
That was later, though, when the computer was right next to the video games, and she would watch me because she just happened to be there. And I'm sure she might have watched me at some point. She played with me, too. But I just remember that moment, like, there was,
you,
like, this kind
so
of,
you
like...
you literally thought that as a 6-year-old that nobody cares that you beat
not,
a game?
Not those, like, I couldn't, like, verbalize even in terms, like, I remember that feeling. And that feeling of, like, I just did this big thing from, like, at least as far as I'm concerned, and, like...
Yeah.
Like, nobody knows. Nobody knows what this means except me. And I didn't even really knew what it meant, but I just knew, like, this was cool. I've never seen the end of a video game before.
That's super interesting. It's weird to me because I never remember having that feeling. I guess I can talk about it when you get to me, but also, like, I'm kind of instilling that in Luke inadvertently, because when we roll credits on a game, I am stoked, and like I get excited, and he gets excited. So
just because you're
at
doing
least
it together,
I care.
You're doing
I'm
it
with,
together.
So I'm with Karch that because it was one of the great benefits of finding friends who loved games, because my parents didn't care about video games at all. So like to beat a game and then have friends to go talk to was finally somebody who like, yeah, I know, that's awesome.
Right.
You didn't have that before then.
Yeah, that was the first one I beat. Jason, what was the first game that you ever beat?
So, in contrast to you, the first game I ever beat
Jason's
was...
Jason's never beaten a game.
I've never beaten a game. the first game, and maybe only game, that I've ever beaten was Super Mario World. I was 4, and I was playing it with my stepdad, and we went effing wild when we beat Bowser. And that's why I've never had that feeling, because he was into games at that point, and like anything I ever played was with him. And when we beat games, like, we went crazy, dude. And I remember beating Super Mario World with him in my uncle's apartment, like when my uncle was probably in college still. And it was his Super Nintendo. So like my stepdad was watching me over at my uncle's apartment, just the two of us, and we were playing Super Mario World, and we would do that all the time. And I just, some of the best memories in my whole life. So anyway, that's one of them, is I remember beating that game.
Cute. Nice. John, what about you?
So when I was real young and we would go up to Ohio to see my dad's brothers, who most of them, you know, live in the same town as where my grandparents were living when they were alive, we would stay with one of my dad's older brothers. And so all of my cousins that, you know, with that uncle and aunt that we were staying with were quite a bit older than me. Eventually we would actually stay with one of my dad's younger brothers, and all his kids were actually closer to my brothers and I's age, which was nice. But what that meant is when we were there, like all the, you know, my older brother, who was, you know, still a couple years younger than the cousins, would run off and they'd do stuff. And I was too young to be involved. And my uncle had a Super Nintendo and they had Link to the Past. So I remember on one of the trips where we went up there for a couple weeks, because I as a child had nothing better to do, because all of my normal toys were home in Florida. I played Link to the Past, and I have like very few memories of actually playing this. And all I remember is obviously I'm like 4 years old and it's Link to the Past. So I'm dying like constantly, but I just kept beating my head against the game, and I beat Link to the Past at like 4 years old.
There's no way you could read anything. That's amazing.
I had no idea what was going on, but I distinctly remember defeating Ganon at the very end. And beating Link to the Past at like the age of 4. My favorite part about that was when I was in college, because, you know, during the semesters I played very few video games, but every summer I would make a point of picking at least one game and beating it. And so one summer I was like, I'm gonna beat Link to the Past again. And so now you have like, I don't know, like 19, 20, 21-year-old Sean playing Link to the Past, and be like, this game is hard. How did I beat this 16 years ago when I was a child?
Kids have like infinite patience for
And that's
crap
the thing.
Like
it, was,
that,
like, it was just like, yeah, I'll just keep beating my head against it. And, you know, it's like, oh my God, this is ridiculous. But yeah, Link to the Past was the first video game I ever beat, and thus was a lifelong love born of the Legend of Zelda series.
Yeah. I remember
my
when
son
you first
will
told
never
us that.
Have that experience, because I can't imagine trying to stay with Greg for more than a week. I mean, come on. I would die.
Yeah.
He could stay with me. That's fine. He just lives a different lifestyle than me, and I just don't know if I can handle it. But if he comes here, that's totally cool.
I wouldn't blame you. I remember when you first told us that you had beat it at that young an age. I was like, that's a lie. He's misremembering something. Because I wasn't introduced to a Zelda game of any kind until much later, knowing how difficult they can be. But, you know, it just spits you right back out of the beginning of the dungeon. And that can be a slog, but like Jason said, when you're a kid, you just don't care.
Just don't care.
Especially on vacation, and like you said, you didn't have anything better to do, and you're four, and you just keep going. You just keep going. And good for you, Sean.
My son does that. He plays Rocket League, and when we first started, he sucked at Rocket League. Like, he couldn't even drive in a straight line. And he just, like, beats his head against it. And, like, the last few times I've seen him play, like, he's going after the ball. He can move the 3D cameras. Like, he understands how to move in 3D. Like, he can drive. He can steer. He goes up the walls. He goes up the ceiling. He runs over the boost pads. He knows how to use the boost. He knows how to score on the right goal. He knows how to customize the cars. I'm just like, holy crap, you're four. I showed you none of this. I gave you the game and said, drive in a straight line, and you're like doing all this stuff, man. So I totally like believe that you did that, and I'm freaking impressed that's amazing.
Now, refresh my memory. You used one of those like joystick pads, right?
When I beat it in college, yeah.
Oh, in college, not as a kid?
Yeah. Yeah, I had one of, like, the arcade pads. Yeah, that was, you know, like the joystick and like six buttons. And I remember I needed that. I was like, I can't do this with the regular controller. Like, I need this bigger in the fidelity here. I was like,
that's funny.
It's a tough game.
All right, Robert, what was the first game you beat?
That would be in relation to Sean's Legend of Zelda: Ocarina of Time.
It's a good one. It's a good first one.
And unlike you two losers, he beat the water temple on his own.
Wow.
But
amazing.
But in your defense, I knew that the water temple was going to be a bitch. I knew ahead of time it was going to be awful. And I also may have borrowed that the kingly best walkthrough of all time. That I don't even remember what the name of it was, but I borrowed it from Sean, and it was for Legend of Zelda.
Oh, my Nintendo Power Ocarina of Time guy.
The one that made it a story. Yeah. Oh,
that guy's actually
in my parents' house somewhere.
It'll make you lose the water temple if you're not careful. So you actually had a handicap using it.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a good first one, though.
Yeah, it was great. It was fantastic.
Classic.
Well, hold on. I got a question for you. Oh. How old were you? And so, like, were you playing it contemporaneous with when it came out, and like the circumstances of when you beat the game? How'd you feel?
I felt like it was a huge accomplishment, because it probably took me like a year to beat, because I was like just going very slowly, and then I would give up for periods of time. So when I got to the end, it was about as eventful as when I finally finished Lord of the Rings.
Nice.
Amazing.
The book, you mean?
Yes. Yeah.
That's a crowning achievement as well. All right. Next up, we have worst purchase. This is just a regretful purchase. What did you buy that you just feel was terrible? I know I'm forgetting some. In fact, when I came up with this question, I probably had a good one. I forgot to write it down. But I mentioned a little bit earlier, Mario Tennis for the Switch was bad. It was bad, 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 bad. And I say I returned it. Jason wanted to know about how I didn't return it, because you can't return open video games for the most part unless you just get the worst employee ever. So I just had to like trade it in, quote unquote, for half price, which, you know, was still better than keeping that piece of junk. And then most recently probably is Ring Fit Adventure. I don't know what I was thinking.
you had aspirations.
I did.
You
I had
said
aspirations.
When you bought it, you were like, I can't wait to not use this in 2 months.
Well, I was right. I didn't use it after 3 weeks. So, all right, Jason, what was your worst purchase?
Okay, so I think I may have spoken about this on the podcast before. And I want to preface by saying, in my life, I've made a lot of terrible purchases, like a lot of terrible purchases.
Just decisions in general.
Bad decisions. Like, my life is a mess. one of my terrible decisions was, at one point in my life, I decided I was going to sell my PS4. I was going to sell my laptop. I was going to sell my microphone. I was going to sell my music interface. I was going to sell everything and dedicate myself to PC gaming, because The PC could replace everything. The PC could replace the laptop. I didn't care about recording anymore. I would replace the console. I was going to set it up in the den, and it was going to be basically just like a console dedicated PC. And within 18 months, I had repurchased everything that I sold. I bought a new laptop. I rebought the same freaking mic that you see in the video here, the Shure SM7B that I sold to my brother for a very, very deeply discounted price. I repurchased this. I repurchased the PS4. I bought a PS4 Pro. Repurchased the music interface. I repurchased everything. And that's not even the dumbest purchase that I've ever made.
Just to clarify, you don't actually regret purchasing the PC, though, right?
Not the PC. It's just the fact that I sold everything all the things, yeah. And I ended up rebuying things I already own. The fact that I repurchased things that I already owned was the dumbest purchase.
Not even the dumbest purchase.
When I was in middle school, my grandparents took me to GameStop for my birthday, and they said, you can buy any two games that you want. And I chose Mario Party because I was super stoked about playing that with like you good and choice. Sean and everybody.
Good choice. Yeah.
And the other one was Superman 64.
One of the worst games of all time.
I remember taking it home though and being actually more excited about Superman because the other one's a party game and was going to play when I got back to Florida. But I was in Chattanooga visiting my grandparents and I was like, I'm playing Superman. And I just remember like flying. And just like being in the air with green all around me and trying to find rings to fly through and literally not knowing what else to do.
Yep.
Oof. So, that's all there was to do.
So I took it back to GameStop literally the next day. And they must have known how bad it was. And there must have been some sort of weird little return policy, kind of like what happened with Cyberpunk. And
well, back then you could return games within like 7 days.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, okay. Well, they let me return it and I got Super Smash Bros. And that was a much better choice.
Nice.
Perfect. Yeah, that game was so bad. I rented it, thankfully. I didn't, because I wasn't like a huge Superman kid. So I was just like, oh, this looks fun at Blockbuster. It wasn't. And so I didn't suffer too much for it. But I'm sorry that you bought it. But at least you got Smash Bros. Out of it. So that's good.
Yeah.
Super happy.
Sean, what was your worst purchase?
I remember from my birthday one year, my parents taking me to the Target there, Boot Ranch, and they were going to let me buy a video game console. And so I was all set, having you know, loved my Super Nintendo. I was going to buy the Nintendo 64. It had come out like a year or two earlier, and somehow I think it was because the Sega Saturn was being sold with like three free games. They convinced me I should buy the Sega Saturn instead.
Oh, parents.
And so I bought the Sega Saturn, and one, you know, I was used to cartridges, you know, cartridges that had save, that maintained their saves on themselves. So I had no idea that I needed a memory card. And mind you, so I bought this, and it came with like Daytona USA and like some time cop shooting game that you needed a gun peripheral to play with, and some other third game. And I bought a couple other games over the years, but also like very soon, like you could tell Sega and like everybody abandoned the Sega Saturn. So you couldn't find anything for this. I was never able to get a memory card for it. And I just always regretted buying that instead of the 64, which incidentally, my older brother, when his birthday came around that July, he got the Nintendo 64.
Question about the Sega Saturn. It seems like your parents kind of push you toward it. And your dad is like a technical guy to like by trade, right?
Yep.
So do you think it's possible he pushed you toward that because he thought it was the better technology, which I think would have been true at the time?
No, I guarantee that my dad was not at all involved and was not even at Target at the time when I made this decision.
Okay, so maybe it's just been a cheaper console.
So this was definitely, it was like $200 for Sega Saturn with three games, and my mom and my older brother convincing me to buy that instead.
Okay,
and
that's fair.
Having that thing sitting in the house and basically collecting, you know, I played it a few times and tried to get games for it, but also trying to play Tomb Raider without the ability to save is somewhat limiting. And thank goodness we eventually got a Nintendo 64 and I was back on the Nintendo track for you know, the next long period of my life.
Thank goodness for that. Robert, what was your worst purchase ever?
It's split between, I would say, the most recent worst purchase, which is a game I had gotten mid-2000s called The Technomancer, which...
Never heard of it.
There's a reason. It was... it was released in alongside AAA games on platforms, but it was like a Russian knockoff of a Bethesda game. It was like if you took KOTOR, Knights of the Old Republic, but then tried to be but their way is garbage. I'm gonna invent my own system from the ground up, but by only remembering what KOTOR did and not actually looking at it. So that's it was the only game that I have actually returned. The next day, I was no, mm-hmm. no, I'm not going to spend money on this.
Hey no, guys, sir. Do you think that's on Steam? We should definitely do a playthrough of that game.
Oh God, no.
Find it cheap.
I remember Robert complaining about this game as this happened.
Yes. I was upset about it, and I'm sure I told everyone. Ugh. So that was the most recent one. But I gotta say, of all time, worst purchase would probably be a Sonic the Hedgehog game that came out on the GameCube. And I can't recall the title exactly, but I'm pretty sure it had Shadow in it.
No! Oh. You are... No! That's one of the best games of all time!
Is he talking about the Shadow spinoff? Oh, wait.
Yeah.
The Shadow spinoff was bad.
Where he has a gun?
Remember?
Yes.
Where he's got guns?
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, because he probably bought that after playing Adventure 2 Battle.
Yes. Yes. The good one had those little chows that you could take care of. I love the crap out of that. I love that. But no, it was the knockoff that was terrible.
Ugh. It's unbelievable they haven't ported that game to modern consoles yet.
I agree.
Where's my 3D Sonic collection?
Yeah, but don't do that. I don't need to spend 2 months raising chows. Don't need that in my life.
Yeah, Mr. Minecraft. Come on. You have the time.
Yeah, and I don't need that either. I don't need the five bajillion hours I've dropped in Skyrim either.
Hey, for the record, I can't believe nobody has noticed the fact that if you go in the dock and look under Sean's games that he played this week.
No, I noticed it.
Oh, okay, you noticed it?
Yeah.
Okay, well, you had actually typed Mibecraft?
Yeah. On purpose.
Yeah.
Oh, you typed Mibecraft?
Yeah.
On purpose, yeah.
On purpose?
The family nickname is Mibes.
Okay, yeah. I didn't realize that. I changed it to Mibecraft because I thought it was a typo.
Jason took his joke and made it worse. Congratulations.
Shut up. Robert, what platform was Technomancer on?
PS3?
Okay, it's on Steam for $4.
The Omega Games.
Get it, Jason. Get it.
I'm doing it. I'm really doing it.
Gross.
$4? I want to see this.
Come on the podcast, Robert. We'll make you relive your worst memories. Next topic is best steal. So this one's kind of vague. I actually went literal with it once I recollected what my actual best steal was. But basically, this is the best deal you ever got in a game, whether that's hours spent, or however you want to classify value, I guess. But I literally stole, through friendship, Robert's PS2
Ooh.
And his PSP.
Ooh.
The PS2 is long gone. I don't know where it is. I'm very sorry about that. But it allowed me to play Kingdom Hearts over and over again and a couple other games I'd never had a chance to play. But more importantly is I still have this as the PSP because I was able to turn that into an emulation device, many years ago. And I used that to play, a bunch of old games, PS1 titles, Super Nintendo, etc. And aside from the fact that the battery does die a little quick, it's still in great condition. Great little handheld. I never had my own, but I stole Robert's. I still have it. And he can't have it back.
Yeah.
And then as far as value goes, Jason didn't want his Vita anymore. And I bought that from him two or three years ago for $60, which if you try to buy a Vita these days, you are not getting it for $60. Especially
now that it's been discontinued. And I paid for shipping.
And he paid for the shipping because he's a dumb
guy. In retrospect, I wish I charged you nothing. Because that's how much you mean to me.
Well, that's
you mean $60.
You can send me that money whenever you want, buddy. No, but I was able to play a couple games that were exclusive to it, and then I also turned that into an emulation device, which was that was the hardest device I've ever had to crack. There were so many steps on that one.
It probably would be easier now because I think they've stopped updating the operating system.
This was only like at most a year ago, probably a little less. And that was only because, like you said, they were done and they had finally found like, but you had to take the firmware back even further still. It was a whole mess. But so much value for $60.
Oh, not to mention that's the OLED version, which is the OG.
Yes.
Because
the best version.
Yep, exactly.
All right, Jason, what is your best steal?
I think I've talked about this on the podcast before, but I'm going to talk about it again. My best steal. On Black Friday, my parents had visited me with my brother and my sister, and all the siblings decided they were going to go out shopping. Oh, I think my sister-in-law was there too. So it was Greg and his fiance, Erin, at the time, now wife. And it was Brandy, my sister, and then my wife and me. And we went out Black Friday shopping, and literally the only thing that I bought, like, they were all buying Christmas gifts and like being all nice and doing things for other people. I bought myself a video game at Best Buy, and I got Dishonored 2, which had very recently launched. I bought it for $20 because it was, or maybe it may have even been $15, but it was at the very least it was $20. I bought it for a deal. Well, Greg and I, he was in town for Thanksgiving and they were leaving on the Sunday. So we went out on Black Friday and we bought the game and we brought it home and we played the crap out of it and we binged it. And I didn't have kids or a dog or, well, I had a dog, but whatever. I didn't have kids. Binged it Friday, binged it Saturday, binged it Saturday night, binged it Sunday. And we beat it. And then I went, and the very next week, I traded it back into Best Buy for $30. So I actually made $10 on the game. Beautiful. And that's the best deal I've ever had.
Yeah.
And I love that game.
Yeah, oh, I still need to go play the Dishonored games. They're on my to-do list.
They're on Game Pass. And one other thing that was funny about it, it was actually, there was a free digital copy of Dishonored 1.
Oh, that came with it?
Yeah, that came with it. So I still have the digital copy of Dishonored 1 tied to my Sony account. Plus, I played the whole Dishonored 2, and then I traded it back in and made $10.
All right, Sean, your best steal?
If we're going to go best steal in the joke sense, I think it has to go with the fact that I stole Karch's pride when I borrowed his PS1 and beat Final Fantasy VII before him. Because I've gotten way too much mileage out of that statement over the course of my life.
And he's going to do that again when he comes to your house, beats Integrate, and leaves.
But no, in all reality, my neighbor had a Nintendo 64, one of the many neighbors, because for whatever reason, the two neighbors on either side of my parents are probably the houses that have flipped the most in our neighborhood. I'll let you decide what that means. One of them was getting rid of their Nintendo 64, and I managed to nab their copy of Harvest Moon 64 because I just basically went through what games they had, and whatever ones I didn't have, they let me keep. Never played a Harvest Moon before that, and honestly led to a long love from that moment forward love of the series, love of those type of games, which is led me to Stardew Valley these days. So. Really just a fortuitous moment that led me to a type of game that I've greatly enjoyed.
Robert, what's your best steal?
My best steal is how I keep stealing Sean's best steal because we shared our youth together.
Youth!
But the best steal after I read Sean's, I realized, was also Harvest Moon 64, which both you, Karch, and you, Sean, I learned about it through you guys, and I was like, holy crap, I didn't realize until that point video games were different than they could be different like that. Like,
right, exactly.
Wait, they don't have to be violent?
Like, I didn't mind violence, but at the same time, I'm like, oh, video games can be relaxing. I didn't realize that. So I remember there was nowhere that would have it because by the time you guys told me about it, or I learned about it, it was already sold out and they weren't even making new copies anymore. They were just done. And I had to go to like a flea market somewhere and I found like the last copy they had and it was like the best find ever, but I did not steal it. But
how much did you pay?
Oh gosh, probably like maybe $20 or something.
That's not bad.
Yeah.
That's good.
Quick. quick shout out to the Florida flea market there off Racetrack Road in Oldsmar, Florida.
Heck yeah,
I bought many of my childhood games at that flea market.
That was a good one. Yeah.
It's such a good place. That's where COVID has lived since you've been gone.
I also definitely believe that.
Yeah, no, before we move on, I got to gush about 64 a little bit too, since you guys both brought it up as best steal, because mine wasn't a steal. Because Robert, you got it for $20 at the flea market. We hunted it down on eBay. Prior to that, I didn't. Maybe we tried the flea market first, or maybe I was too stupid or something. I don't know. But we ended up spending like $65 plus shipping to get some pretty pristine. It wasn't in box, but it was a good copy that probably still works to this day. I just don't know who has it, me or my sister. But yeah, it's so funny that Sean and I discovered this game like almost simultaneously.
Yeah,
but like separately, because I was actually hanging out with Robert. You remember Travis Furman? Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
God, I remember Travis. Yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. That's where I was over at his house and he had it and he thought it was stupid. I was like, what's this? He's like, ah, it's dumb. I was like, let me boot it up. I was like, can I borrow it? And then he's like, no, it's awesome. I want to play it. Game you can never beat. I can't beat this dead horse too much, but I will never beat The Witcher 3. I've tried.
Same.
I can't even get halfway through The Witcher 3, so I'll definitely never beat it. But yeah, I just can't do it. Can't do it. I don't know why, but I can't do it. There's lots of games I haven't beat, and so technically could never beat, but I don't think there's a game I've tried to beat as often and failed at miserably.
Right.
And not because I'm bad at it, and not because it's bad. It just wasn't meant to be.
It just it has not spoken to you.
It hasn't.
No, it's like when you meet a romantic part or interest, right? And yeah. You're getting in the mood, right? You're about to lean in for the kiss, and something awkward happens. And then it happens again.
Burps in my face.
And then it happens again. Each time you don't finish that game is a burp in your face killing the mood of why you want to finish that game.
Kurt does not want to finish this game.
Well, right. Because he burped in my face. Geralt is a rude face burper.
Yes.
And so I no longer want to finish it.
Yeah.
Jason, what is the game that you could never beat?
What eludes me? Anything over 30 hours. Can't do it. Any Souls game also can't do it. But the game that I've actually tried to beat that I haven't, and it's kind of like The Witcher for you, is God of War from 2018. I love it. I love that game. I love the combat. I love everything about it. I've started it, I don't know, two or three times, and there's just, I always get distracted. I can't... It's not tangible, the reason why I can't beat it. I cannot put my finger on what it is about the game that I can't seem to finish. But alas, I haven't beaten it.
I want to kick you off this podcast till you beat that game. I won't, but I want to.
Try me. I actually invented this podcast so that my friends would make it for me so I could listen. So now I've got you, Karch, and Robert. I've got three chairs I can exit and just listen every week.
You would never come back to the podcast, Sean. Sean's, you know, threat would go unanswered.
Right,
forever.
That's true.
Like many of my threats in life.
Can't do it.
Sean, what about you? What's something you could never beat?
This one makes me sad to this day. So I loved Final Fantasy Crystal Chronicles on the GameCube. Mm-hmm. And there was a brief period where we played that game together, but with the whole annoyance with the GBA hookup, we eventually stopped. But I kept playing that game, and I played that game like on and off from whenever it came out through the end of the useful life of my GameCube. And I remember, like, I eventually got to, like, the last level and, like, the second to last, you know, there's the boss and then some story and then, like, the big final boss. Like, what you thought was the boss wasn't the final boss type of moment, because obviously I've read ahead at this point. And what I learned at that point was, despite the hours I had sunk into that game, I was woefully under, not leveled because the game doesn't work in levels, but my stats were under what they needed to be able to beat that game reasonably. Mm-hmm. And I tried a couple times because, like, I could take like two hits. So like I could take a hit, heal, get some more damage on the enemy, you know, invariably get another hit and heal. But like, if I wasn't flawless, I was going to eventually take that second hit and die. Mm-hmm. And I could just never beat that game. And I always wanted to see that game to completion, because the whole concept of like memory and the, you know, Murph and the miasma, I always really enjoyed like the world and the way that game was set up, and I wanted to see it to completion, and I never was able to, and I remain sad about that, and it's one of the biggest reasons I was so upset that the remaster that came out last year wasn't very good, and I will always be disappointed that I never beat Crystal Chronicles.
I think you owe it to yourself to get that remaster and do it.
I was going to say that. It's only bad in the way that it handles multiplayer.
And apparently, like, the load times for even, like, the little five-second cutscenes that happen every so often.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Still, you don't want to leave that hanging forever.
Yeah, probably.
You're going to die on your way down here or something. What did we say earlier? Stress was going to kill you?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, that's what it was. Got to do it.
You gotta let that go.
It's stress or the radiation. Yeah, at some point, or the asbestos, or the lead, or the PFAS. My medical record's getting pretty thick with things that I have to document.
I don't even know what that last one was, but don't tell me because I want to hear from Robert.
It's plastic, it's chemical.
Oh my
gosh! Crap.
What did I just say?
It puts it in the water.
That's my fault. I shouldn't have said the
Jason
thing.
Jason is almost right, but he's also not right, so he did not spoil it for you.
Spoil it for him?
Yeah, he did not spoil what is possibly killing me.
It's a boiler cast.
I want to be surprised.
Boil water.
I want to open the casket at the funeral and be like, "Oh, that's what it was." Robert, what could you never get to the end of?
Less interesting answer is a recent game called Code Vein that I played. That was like a one of those things where you can like customize it so incredibly much with like your equipment and like your loadout for a form you use or the class and all this other stuff. And I got all the way to the end and it turned out the build I was using, you could not use to beat the final boss. And it was like one of those roguelites where you would keep playing the same level over and over again to get more and more of the stuff to buy permanent upgrades. And then if you died, you lost it. So I just gave up on that. But so that was that's a slightly less interesting one. But the more controversial one is I actually never got to the very end of the very original Final Fantasy VII.
Yay!
No, don't say yay. We don't condone that.
I condone it so hard.
I don't know. He said it like Fry says it, so I kind of.
We gotta rectify that. Gotta rectify.
Yeah, I'll do it if I have motivation. It was just playing alone as a younger kid with like every five steps when you couldn't control the encounters. Like I got fed up with it. I'm like, I'm done.
You still can't control the encounters.
Yes, you can.
Yeah, you can.
You can turn them off in the new versions. In the
new
version, you can turn it off.
Yeah. No, not in the Game Pass version.
Yes, you can.
Because I'm playing it right now.
Just because you don't know how to hit the L2 button while the pause menu's up doesn't mean it's not there. So if you wanted to cheat your way through, it's very easy to do.
Robert, I'm just saying, if you come up here, I'll kick Katie off of my Final Fantasy VII video, and you can join me. You and I can play through Final Fantasy VII.
Yes, it's not
Robert
that long
has to
of a
do
drive.
The girl voices, though.
You can do it once a week.
Okay. Yeah, that is true. You're going to have to do all the female voices.
I can do that, no problem. Sure.
Let's do this.
Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I every single phone call I ever make, I'm mistaken for a woman anyways, so...
What?
Yeah,
how?
It's true. What? I'm not kidding.
I've had that happen to me.
I get ma'am.
Like a super husky
like,
woman.
Ridiculous. Like, like, you would not believe I get ma'amed until I say Robert, and then they always, like, there's this moment of silence where they're waiting for me to either get upset at them or to, like, for them to be like, okay, I can just ignore this now. Okay. Yeah.
That makes no
sense. That's amazing. I get that too.
That makes even... No, none of this is... You guys are
lying. I get it all the time. They're like, okay, Miss Jessie.
Miss Jessie. Well, if it says Jessie for whatever reason, that's stupid too. Then it makes sense that they would say Miss, but still.
Well, in everyone else's defense, not mine, when I'm like... not talking to you guys, I use a softer voice if I'm like at work or something. So
yeah, I mean, that's like maybe your hello, maybe just like your greeting I could see, but every word out of your mouth after that, with your softer tone, would still be masculine.
He sounds like this. He's like, hi, I'm Robert.
No, this is literally what it's like. It sounds like this when I talk very softly.
That sounds even more manly to
me. Oh, it does? Well, then I don't know what the fuck is going on here.
You sound like you're seducing me. That's sensual. I like it.
That's the voice I use when I'm hypnotizing people therapeutically.
Wow. Dude, that would hypnotize the hell out of me.
But that's also my phone voice.
We'll do a special episode where Robert hypnotizes Jason.
We're doing an OnlyFans. Yeah. We're starting an OnlyFans, and it's just Robert talking to you as a therapist. It's ASMR role play.
Hey, if we get money off that, why not?
We would.
Jason's been trying to start an ASMR podcast since we started this podcast.
Oh, I could. Yeah, I could do that for Jason anytime he wants.
I have. Don't edit that out.
Oh, I'm gonna edit it out.
Couldn't hear it either.
With prejudice. All right. Final topic before we wrap it up. Game that you've played the most, and by no contest, my game is easily World of Warcraft. There's no way that I haven't sunk the most hours, you know, by minutes and hours and seconds into World of Warcraft, and I enjoyed most of those. Some of those were just obligatory and going through the motions, but I played a great deal of it in my younger years with Robert and Kit, and I liked it. But if we're talking about like playthroughs of games. Just kind of a cheaty answer, but like without a doubt, it's got to be Final Fantasy VII, VIII, and IX. I've played through those games at least combined more than any other game, and I've started all three of them quite a bit, only to get about halfway through and just kind of be like, "All right, that's good enough for now." Of course, I'm going through that bet, so I'll be finishing them to completion this year, and I can't wait because those games are awesome, and I don't regret that at all. And there's, you know, a lot of other games and genres. Like I've sunk a lot into the Harvest Moon series. I've sunk a lot of time into Smash Brothers in general, but you know,
haven't we all?
Right, exactly. I mean, video games are my life, so this answer could just keep going on and on. So, Jason, what's yours?
I have a similar kind of answer to you, and it will probably be of no surprise to anybody who's listened to like more than three episodes. But Diablo 2 is probably the most hours, kind of like akin to your World of Warcraft. Like that was my one game that I've ever played where I was invested in the end game, and I don't know what it was about it. I think it was like a mixture of the toxic online environment with the rush.
Love a toxic.
I do. It's my upbringing, but I love the toxic environment mixed with like the you striving to get the best gear, you striving to like just loot. And I don't know. I don't know what it is. Here's what I'll say. If my ancestors swapped places with me, they'd be billionaires because I have little to no morals. My ancestors were better people than I am.
Here's how you make a sociopath, kids.
But my second answer, like you, talking about the game you played the most, replayed the most times, put the most effort into. Yours is Final Fantasy VII. Mine is Super Mario World. Like, I beat that game when I was 4. I think I've beat it on every platform it could possibly be played or emulated. I mean, I've beat it on the PSP in a movie theater waiting for what was that C.S. Lewis book that they made into a movie?
Chronicles of Narnia.
The first movie of that. I freaking beat Super Mario World emulating on my PSP waiting for that movie to start. And so Super Mario World and Diablo 2. And that's all I have to say.
Cool. Sean.
Yeah, this was clearly a really hard one for me. I played so many games and it's Skyrim. It has to be Skyrim. I've played a ridiculous, insane amount of Skyrim. To the point where I'm somewhat ashamed of it, and I have buried more hours in Skyrim and beaten the main storyline in Skyrim at least 3 times, if not more. It's just Skyrim.
Wow.
If there was a platinum trophy, would you have earned it?
No, because invariably some platinum would require you to be evil, and I'm just terrible at being evil. I just can't be evil.
I mean, there's a gamer score for it, and he played it on his Xbox.
Yeah, but I don't have all of the achievements because some of them require you to do evil things.
Right, that's what I figured.
Yeah.
After you
always the Boy Scout, always the Eagle Scout.
But all right,
it is a little. All
right, so but you've played Skyrim, Sean. But honestly, compared to Fallout.
Yeah, but so here's the thing: is I played a lot of Fallout 3 and New Vegas, but like I got Skyrim, and then it came out like, and I played a lot of Skyrim on the 360. And did like everything you could, and then it came out on the one, and I got it again, and now I could download mods.
Oh, okay. So you just keep getting pulled back in.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, I'm done. And it's like, you know what? And I'll be like on Reddit because I follow like the Skyrim Xbox mod page. I'm like, oh, that's a cool mod. I bet I could make a cool load order that makes use of that mod. And then I'm back in. Yeah, it was honestly the only because I did that with Oblivion for a little while on my my college laptop. And the only thing that probably stopped me from going down that was one, college, and two, it was a laptop, and therefore I really couldn't do that much. Mm-hmm. Because I did that. I played a lot of Oblivion. Not nearly. I still probably played less Oblivion than I did between Fallout 3 and Fallout New Vegas, especially because. But I have played, probably approaching five times as much Skyrim as I have the next closest game, if not more. I've played way too much 10 Skyrim. Years?
Ugh. So Todd Howard sleeps well at night off the backs of
I'm
people.
Sure.
Or he doesn't, because I've only bought the game twice. I mean,
people like
that's not. Yeah, that's true.
Otherwise, he wouldn't be able to keep re-releasing it. All right, Robert, bring us home. What are the games that you've played the most?
All right. Hours-wise, probably split evenly between World of Warcraft, which I played with you and Kit, and Elder Scrolls between both, and I'm counting Oblivion and Skyrim combined, because, I got addicted to Oblivion hardcore when I was playing that game when I was a teenager. Like, I could not stop. It was too good. Like,
remember Shivering Isles?
Oh, that was all...
Oh, that was such a good DLC. That's one of the best DLCs I think I've ever played.
The first one, right?
It was after Knights of the Nine. Right. It was the last one they did for Oblivion.
It's the only one I remember. Yeah.
But it was good. It was so good. It was all good. They kept coming out with more good stuff. So both of those I've spent like too many hours of my life doing. However, if I had to say like a video game that I've played the most, it would probably be those Monkey Island games that LucasArts originally came out with.
Oh yeah,
Double Fine, I think, was the developer.
Yes.
Not originally. Wasn't it? They were made in house by LucasArts.
Yes. Yeah. That was before Double Fine, because.
But was Pete? What's his name? Pete Fiennes?
No. I'm not sure about him. I know Tim Schafer or somebody.
Yeah, Tim Schafer. That's the guy I'm thinking of.
He might have done it at Monkey Island, but I could be wrong here.
He worked it. He worked at LucasArts because he did Day at the Tentacle too, and then eventually he split. He had his own company, and that was
gotcha. Yeah, mm-hmm.
But over the years, that's been my comfort game that I just continue to go replay over and over and over again. Like, it's just too good.
I can't wait to get Luke into adventure games, because. That, like, I remember Monkey Island being kind of one of my first forays into like a choice based thing having an outcome in a game. And I remember really liking that game. And even though I was probably too old for them, I remember liking games like Spy Fox or Pajama Sam or whatever it was.
Putt Saves the Zoo.
I remember like actually liking playing those games with Greg, even they were a little babyish, just because I was like, oh, the mystery. I got to find the clues. I got to do the things. Like, that's what Monkey Island gave to me, too, that I had never really experienced before.
Yeah, I played the Nancy Drew ones with Hannah, and those were fun. I remember, Robert, I watched you play, or I knew that you liked the Monkey Island, and I'd never played them. And you were like, you won't like them. And I was like, what do you know? And I was like, Robert likes them. I can like them too. And so I found them cheap on Steam or something. And I was like, these suck. Why would Robert lie to me? Like, I was just betrayed, even though he prepared me for every moment of it. He was right. It's not that I didn't like them. It's just because I said it just a second ago. I had played the Nancy Drew ones, and like, I knew what an adventure game was, but they were a different kind. They were old school.
Oh yeah.
And even though they had like updated the graphics, they'd changed nothing else. And the most fun I had was you could hit like F something on the keyboard and it would immediately swap between the new hand drawn and the old pixel graphics. And I thought that was amazing. I was like, just technologically, I was like, wow, this is cool. But that was the extent of the fun I had with it. Well, I played King's Quest too, and I died a lot.
Yeah, that's where I get my sense of humor from. Okay, Monkey Island.
That jives.
The writing in that.
For anybody who liked Monkey Island, Psychonauts 2 is coming out in August.
I love Psychonauts. Oh, I loved Psychonauts.
Still need to play the first one.
I have never played Psychonauts 1, so but good. I played the VR title, which was the
I did that too.
Columbus of Ruin.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
It was okay.
Yeah. So anyway, I really enjoyed that on the PS VR, and I felt like, okay, this is the evolution of adventure games. I would totally be willing to check out Psychonauts 2 just based on how much I liked that little VR title. And that comes out, again, like I said, in August. And that's Double Fine, who are ties to Tim Schafer, ties to Monkey Island.
It is Tim Schafer.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I know. I'm saying then that ties
well,
to
you
Monkey
said Island. Well, I wanted to be clear. Like, he's making that game.
Right, right, right.
Nice. And it's owned by Xbox. So,
yep.
Game Pass.
Cool. Good.
All right. Well, Jason, you bring us all the way home.
Okay, I will, because I'm going to say later, Skater. I love this podcast. I love video games, and I love you three lovely NFers.
Yeah.
That's all we have for you this week. You guys have a great week. Have a great fourth. Don't blow anything up or burn anything down. We will try, but we are never free to play.
At least he doesn't have to take just as many bathroom breaks like 30 minutes later, because that would be even worse.
I guarantee he probably goes to the bathroom when he gets his drink.
Well, at least he doesn't take the podcast with him.
Like he does the D&D session?
Yes.
Hey, I'm going to the bathroom. I tried to mute you. Too bad if it didn't work. God. I'll find my B-roll somewhere in here. That's for sure.